Is that tap water?
Yeah.
Hearing our landmark church tell us it's the appointed hour, we call the Board of Selectmen to order for May 17th of 2016. We've got a pretty full agenda tonight. We'll be moving right back to the liaison reports and to the town manager's comments. We've got several proclamations to consider and act on. There'll be a continued hearing from our last meeting on the liquor license for the Art Lounge on Haven Street. In keeping with the visits from our advisory committees, the Climate Advisory Committee will be in to see us for a thorough report, as always. Trails Committee as well. There will be a hearing opening shortly after 8 o'clock on Hartshorn Avenue and Bancroft Avenue parking, and that'll be immediately followed by some discussions of the wayfinding signs at Morton Field. We're going to have visitors from North Reading, actually, their Board of Selectmen. I think a quorum will be present, and they'll be calling themselves to order here to join us in a discussion about the strategic alliance that is bubbling between the two towns around the MWRA. There's also going to be some changes in liquor licenses, Anthony's Coal Fire, and also in restaurant Pavarotti. So that being the case, I think what we should do is move the selectmen's liaison reports. Barry.
I have a couple of things, but I know we have a full agenda, so I'll be brief. I did attend last week the audit committee auditing our books through June of 2015. The good news is we're not broke. We're in good shape. And actually, the auditors were really Melanson and Heath, who, by the way, we did re-up again for a three-year term that was approved at the meeting. They love coming to Reading because we are one of the few audit committees that actually engages them and asks questions. And they get excited about that, as auditors do. Just a couple of things that, and I brought a copy here. I know, Bob, you probably have it, but if Kevin or John. A couple of things that I wanted just to point out. This is the first audit that, under the GASB 68 rule, which now moves our pension liability to the balance sheet. We always notated it, obviously, in the notes, but GASB now requires it to actually show on the balance sheet. So if you look year to year, it looks we have a weaker balance sheet, but we're just putting our pension liabilities
right
now in the front of it, of the book, instead of the back of the book. And also our OPEB liabilities, I think next year or 2018, I forget, are also going to go to the balance sheet. So that's going to make it look even worse. We asked the question, will the rating agencies look at this and say, oh, Reading's now in bad shape? They understand that, that's the regulation, and they kind of work around that. So the fact that our balance sheet looks less strong than it did is not a concern. They think that we're in good shape, we're doing all the right things. Couple of things that we had asked them to look at last time around the school revolving funds, reported on that. They're going to continue. We voted to continue to look at that for next year and make sure that those are spent down to.
Have there been some changes, some positive changes?
Some positive changes there, but we're going to continue to look at it. And we also decided, in terms of what to look at for next year, I don't know, is Laura here, Laura Jem? We're gonna be looking at the town clerk's office too, and the way that they handle cash.
You don't want her to.
So if Laura's here, you know, well, she's got a police escort in the back, you know. So that'll be what we kinda look at.
Gardener door back there.
For next year, but otherwise, obviously, you know, as we've been reporting all along, the state of our finances is strong.
Yeah, and those two items are, they've been lurking anyway, it's not as though.
Right, no.
It's actually probably better to get them out more clearly in the light of day.
Right, and so things like, what gets looked at is that there's sort of, anything that, any department that handles money, gets audited sort of on a regular basis. I don't think we had the clerks, looked at in a while, so this isn't a trigger of anything that we think there's anything wrong, it's just a normal process of looking at all departments that handle money, and then they'll come up with some recommendations.
Yep. Well, as I remember from serving on that committee, isn't there an automatic selection of one or two areas?
Yeah.
That, you know, just, it's like your turn.
Right, exactly, exactly.
So, they get closer scrutiny, and, you know, you kinda go through that cycle, as I remember.
And they'll come up with maybe some best practices that maybe we're not doing to think about, so we're in good shape there. Also, attended the library building committee, we're getting sorta down to the end of that. You know, we're gonna spend the money that we're supposed to spend. As you get to the end, there's some things that might get pulled out, and either get, you know, done at a later time, but the idea here is to finish this thing under the budget that was voted. So, you know, the architect and the project manager and the contractor, they're all kind of working together. There was, you know, a couple of hiccups in terms of trying to get things done, but they presented a plan that looks like in good shape, and all, you know, it'll be done, you know, in the summer with a fall opening. So,
what's the target?
I think, Bob, correct me if I'm wrong, opening in October?
They want to have some kind of a formal opening in October, and they hope to have a soft one earlier.
Yeah, but I mean, the idea is that the building's going to be done sooner than that. And the idea is that as they're finishing up, they're going to start fitting it with the furnishings and the fixtures. So kind of as they do it, they'll move in and then hopefully go out the door. But as you know, with a new library, you know, any new building, it's going to take, especially with a lot of new technology, it's going to take the staff a while to kind of figure out how it works. So the building part will be done, but I think it's going to, I don't know, Bob, how much time we allotted for kind of them to kind of just sort of learn the building, figure out all that stuff, and then to open it up in the fall.
Yep.
So, but you know, it's gonna come in. We're gonna finish it with the allotted amount of money.
Barry, I know when they were out here
discussing with us, they did mention that they were gonna have to pull some stuff from the table. Is there any specifics that they've gotten to yet that they've kind of figured out from?
No, I think they're still. I mean, they're still trying to sort of assess. You know, this kind of like a list of things that, like, if the worst case scenario comes, it'll be over budget, but now they're looking at things to either delay or buy or do fundraising on. Nothing major. I mean, obviously anything major in the building is going to get done, but things that could get delayed. So, and also contracts that, you know, sort of final numbers that can kind of get skewed down. They're trying to figure out like what's the worst case scenario, but as it gets closer, it may not need to be as much, but so they're just sort of juggling those last few things and kind of, you know, getting obviously the things that need to get done, and then, you know, pull out the stuff that could either wait or get done privately. So.
Okay, and the stuff that they're kind of pulling out, are they thinking maybe, you know, set it up so you don't have to do not too much of an intrusion to add it later?
Yeah, no, that's
that
all. Right, no,
okay.
Oh, yeah. The thing that's right. Gonna, right, no, it, like, they're not gonna have to
good.
Reopen one.
Good,
I mean,
good,
just,
okay.
Yeah, no, nothing like that. So, and then the other thing I'm sure you guys will report on as well, Dan and John and I attended the North Reading meeting. They'll be here later, so I don't want to go too much details on that.
Sure.
And it's just been a busy couple of weeks.
Any update? Has the library committee, has the trustees met around any personnel issues?
As of the last time, no. They had not. I think Ruth Urell, as you all know, is resigned. Mm-hmm. I think her last day is Memorial, end of May.
Wow.
Yeah.
That has not received a lot of publicity in the paper.
No.
Yeah, the trustees said they were meeting last night to name an interim, but I haven't heard.
Okay.
I mean, it,
I just, you know, thought you might have heard, because I know that you're a
no,
regular
attender.
No,
in fact, yeah, I did not hear. you know, so I don't want to speculate.
No,
but
of course not.
They're gonna, you know, they're probably just gonna keep the ship in the, you know, in the direction it's going. So, but that, but the one thing that the trustees did talk about was that, you know, going with an interim until the building is done, and then at that point do a search for a permanent director. But
well, it sounds like they got a lot on their.
They have a lot on their plate.
That makes a lot of sense, actually, if that's what they decide to do. That ball's in their court, certainly.
So, and that's it.
Okay. Dan?
No report.
Okay. Kev?
The only report I'll have, I didn't attend the last ZBA meeting. I did watch it back, though I know Bob was in attendance there. So for all those who've been paying attention, the last Zoning Board of Appeals meeting, they had the applicant in for the 40B development down on Prescott and Lincoln. The applicant came in with some rather good news. They had been working both through us and with the owner of Brown's Automotive to try to acquire that corner piece in part of their project. And I think it was a little close to an 11th hour deal. At 1:30 that day that the zoning board was meeting, they were able to enter into an agreement, Brown's Automotive. So they now control all three parcels there on the corner of Lincoln and Prescott. As such, you know, with plans that were supposed to be, or I should say, they were supposed to be going into this meeting with a lot more readiness for their old project. You know, on really a request from me, I had actually asked them probably about 6 weeks prior, just after the last CBA meeting, to just kind of hold off on going crazy spending money on the older project. While we tried to work out and see if we could get Brown's back into the mix. So I know there was some speculation that the applicants were dragging their feet a little bit. I'm sure they were to a degree. They always seemed to be, but it was more trying to make it a better project overall by acquiring that corner piece, which they were able to do. So at this point, they had asked for an extension on that hearing in order to come up with more plans, now new plans, that involved the corner piece as well and part of the project. As such, they also granted, believe it was a 90-day extension. I think they requested a 60-day extension to the time clock that was ticking from the state. The Zoning Board of Appeals then asked for a 90-day, which the applicants granted to them. So it seems like there's a good enough time.
Well, that's
time
a lot
now.
Of positive.
Yeah, it seems like there's a lot of positive movement down there.
One question on that, Mr. Chairman. Was there any indication from the applicant as to whether the number of units in the overall development would change as up or down as a result?
I think Bob's got
they made three statements. One, that the projects would not increase, would very likely decrease the number of units.
Very good.
They would lose a floor.
Okay.
They would pull
That's
back
good.
All the setbacks
That's very good.
In every direction.
That's all good.
Did they talk about parking at all? Or?
Did not talk about parking.
And I would like to point out, you know, I've been involved with them, but Bob and Gene have also really done a lot of work. You know, Gene really gave us a blueprint of what to show them, what Reading, you know, somewhat expects a little bit more under a rather than a 40B that is pushed down our throat. That's something that we'd like to consider unofficial friendly 40B and how those setbacks work. So I think a lot of that talk coming from Bob and Gene, you know, allowed them to say, okay, we do need to step this back. We do need to, you know, knock a floor off and consider the density. So, you know, there's definitely, it was, I think, a lot of good work behind the scenes to try to get them to this point. We'll see what plans they come up with. For the 23rd of June will be the next CBA meeting that they're attending.
23rd of June?
Correct.
Does that really give them enough time? I mean, you know, they basically, I mean, they spent a lot of time and money, obviously, on the design that they had.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't until like a week ago that they knew they even had.
Well, so they spent a lot of time maybe on the last project they had. I don't know if they spent a lot of money. And I don't mean that in a derogatory manner. I actually, it's more in line with what the applicants' thought process was all along. They really wanted to say, we think this is an interesting project. Can you please pull it apart and see what you don't like about it?
Right.
Now, they didn't do it in those, when you say that in those terms, but they certainly went about it in that procedure. So they really didn't spend a whole lot of time putting in the fine pieces without getting input back from our peer consultants to say, well, that's not going to work there. That's not going to work there.
Well, I think that's what you got from the peer consultants was.
Well, we got a lot from the peer consultants.
So there was
the architect especially was pointed some, you know, some pretty big holes in their old project that they really weren't going to come back from.
Especially the staging of equipment. That was the one that really struck me.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's crucial.
So is I've worked on development projects. It's hard to say, okay, now you're scrapping this and coming up. I hope that the expectation is that that when they come back, was it June 23rd?
It was June 23rd. However, it was requested of them that night that they get the plans to everybody 2 weeks prior so the peer consultants can re-review them, so the town can re-review them, you know, with plenty of time prior to that.
I mean, how much expectation, what's the expectation of them being able to come up with a plan now that they have a totally different site? I mean,
they probably have one today. I've spoken to all the applicants. I'll reiterate again, one of the applicants, Matthew Roman, and I went to high school together. I think I've told this board before. I don't feel it's a conflict of interest.
Right,
because until this came up, we really didn't see each other except for passing every now and again. So, but I've spoken to both him and Matt Zucker, and they're very confident. Their architect can turn things around very quickly. You know, they always had this kind of in the back of their head, as well as a wish for this project to have that corner piece and have all three lots. So I think they already had something that they were conceptually in the design phase of.
I mean, the only reason why I asked the question the way I did is that obviously there's going to be a project they're going to live with forever.
Right.
So if it takes another 30 days to have them come back with something that's right, if it takes them more time to get it right,
I don't think the expectation, I think that's why they granted the 90-day extension. I don't think the expectation on the 23rd is to have everything settled.
Okay.
My guess is that could be a kind of a treetop level discussion. And the beauty of this, and I just will say, Kevin, I think the whole town owes you a debt of gratitude for the hard work you've done, the fact that we've got experienced professional staff working for the town.
Yeah, Bob and Gene were really instrumental.
I mean, between the three of you guys working so closely with all parties, you know, just to kind of keep them together and keep them talking. I mean, there was a lot of concern, and still is, you know, in the neighborhood and in the town. And, you know, as Barry points out, I'm hopeful, as he is, that they take under advisement all of the things that they've heard. And it sounds like they've positioned themselves to be able to truly be what they claim to have always wanted to be, which is a friendly 40B.
Yeah, they've certainly come more back into that fold, which is nice to see. And,
yep.
And you know, I don't think anything's ever going to be perfect or be 100% acceptable, you know, certainly to the abutters. I know there's going to be plenty of concerns and obviously very warranted, but I think this is a good step in a much better direction than what we were looking at before.
I mean, the thing is, a lot of the abutters, or the people who sort of organize themselves, you know, to their credit, I didn't hear one or read in social media or the papers or talk to anybody that said, I don't want that project there. They said, we support the idea of developing that, but we needed to do it in a community-friendly way.
Yeah.
So, you know, if the developers are responding, good for them.
Good for us, too.
It's good for us.
Well, good deals only are good when everybody, you know, gets...
Not quite everything.
When everybody is,
everybody's got to win a little,
yeah.
And everybody gives in a little, and that seems to always be the, you know, the best projects and the best solutions. And looks like we may be pointed there. Really excellent work by both you and Bob and Gene. You know, presenting opportunities. So,
one great. Of you guys read The Art of the Deal? Okay.
Do you have an?
That's all I have.
So my report is a little different than a strict liaison report. I just wanted to comment on something that I've been observing now for really a number of months, and it's kind of come home to me in a very pronounced way over the course of the last 30 days. I work at Sanborn Place. It's our, you know, a great many of our senior and disabled population live there. And as you might imagine, there's a lot of visitation from public safety. There's EMT visits, there's the fire department visits. And I think it's important to say out loud how lucky we are to have the people that we have in this town. You know, I observe, you know, EMTs come into that place, and it's not, you know, let's get them in the ambulance and get down the road and get it over with. It's instead, what's the situation? Help evaluate it. Do your best. I mean, you know, it's very difficult for some of these people to be out of their environment because they're settled. They're very settled. It's a settled population. And I just think it's important to say out loud how lucky we are to have the caliber of people we have coming out of the fire department with the EMTs, and to watch them, you know, compassionately and gently work with, you know, a population that's very much at risk. And I get to see it. I wish I didn't see it as often as I do, but, you know, I'm going to tell you that there's probably not a week that goes by that we don't have a visit. But we don't always have a transport to the hospital, which is really important. Often, you know, I watched last week them working with somebody, and they evaluated the situation and thought really if they sat and spent a little time that, you know, they could help stabilize the situation so somebody could stay at home. And so I think it's important to say that. The other thing that I had occasion to do this morning was to visit the Mystic Regional Emergency Planning Committee, of which we are prominent members, 21 community members, I think. Chief Sagala was there, Chief Burns was there. We had quite a showing. Our town manager was there. And it's just kind of interesting to me that we labor over some small things and don't realize the big things that are going on in the background. I mean, you know, there was items being talked about today about response to active shooters. I mean, just things that were being taken care of in the background, you know, by our public safety team, and they're collaborating so that no one town has to spend all the money and all the resources, because no one town, I think you'd probably bear me out on this, Chief, that nobody could do it alone, you know, all of the things that need to be done. But most importantly, with all due respect to my friend, the Chief, I did find out this morning what chaos means, because they talked about chaos in an emergency setting. And what they said was, chaos is the Chief has arrived on scene. Everything's an acronym with them. Yes, so that's kind of how they define chaos. I left it alone, Chief. I leave that for however you want to run with that. But anyway, I just think it's important for our town to realize that there's a lot going on in the background that we probably don't even realize, you know, the hard work that's going on to keep us safe and to keep us moving down the road. Bob, what do you have for us?
Public comment.
Oh, public comment. Public comment. I'm gonna get this probably about the time that you guys replace me. Anything from the public? All good, huh? You're not gonna respond to that chaos thing? Okay. Bob.
First of all, thank you for your comments, especially on this morning. You're right, there's a lot that goes on in town government that we hope people never do see and never have a cause to see. But it should be no surprise at all that there's 21 communities, 20 other ones are good communities, but Reading is generally looked at as the most well-prepared. And the one fellow in the room, with all respect to this chaos fellow sitting next to me, Chief Burns is acknowledged as the one who knows absolutely every rule, every detail, every manual, and every emergency procedure that there is. And it's very impressive also to see police and fire working together so well. And, you know, as the Chief can tell you, we do that really well in Reading. Not every community does, but under a framework like you saw this morning, there's a firefighter and a police officer leading this effort jointly, which is good to see. It's really important to do a lot of planning because, as was mentioned earlier today, some of the incidents now take 3 or 4 minutes to happen. There's no time to sit down, read a manual, and plan then. You have to have it cold. So thank you for commenting on that. That is work that, again, we hopefully stays in the back room. In your packet over the weekend, I just wanted to show you an example. We don't usually do a lot of this, but the finance department put together an outstanding receivables report of our 25 peer communities. This is on the success of collecting taxes and other fees. Reading has 760,000 outstanding, according to DOR. The only one of the 25 other communities with less is Linfield, and they're a lot smaller, at 500,000. So, you know, most parts of the organization do an outstanding job. It's hard to measure some of them. This just gives you one glimpse into our collectors. You know, they're doing an outstanding job collecting money so that we have cash flow. And that's one of the reasons we have a AAA. It's good discipline. The other item I wanted to put in front of you is in the form of a motion. We've worked with some residents on County Road, and just as full disclosure, there are about 7 or 8 houses away from me. I haven't met them, but I'm sure I will. I'm also on County Road. When they moved in over the winter, they noticed they had low water pressure, and they called our DPW out there. And you know, after some time, they indeed measured and said, "You do," and it's our obligation to provide a certain minimum water pressure. And none of us really know why the prior owner, who was an elderly gentleman who sold it, had not complained, but it appeared that the low water pressure had been going on for quite some time. There's a little bit of an elevation of the house. In the capital plan, there's a long-term solution, but it's at least 3 years away. So there was a short-term solution to get these folks through the next 3 years. And after a discussion with town council, I've got a motion in front of you that the residents went out and bought equipment. Our water department guided them on what equipment to buy. They used their own plumber to install it. They will own it. They will be responsible for the upkeep and maintenance of it. But we owe them the cost of purchase and installation, certainly. And the best way to do that, probably the only real way to do that, is by abating water charges. And since they just moved in January, most of those abatements will go forward. So we'll only be able to go backwards through January. But I've put a motion in front of you, and after some conversation with Barry, I did amend, and just to make sure, it's the cost of what was just done in May of 2016, in case they do some future work that's unrelated.
Yep. Got it.
Okay. Move that the Board of Selectmen, acting in their role as Water and Sewer Commissioners, agree to fully abate the May 2016 cost of equipment installation at 106 County Road in order to remedy a low water pressure situation. This abatement will be funded by the Water Enterprise Fund and include all water bills previously paid in fiscal year 2016 by the current residents, and continue for all future water bills for these residents until the above costs have been fully repaid by the town.
I'll second.
Discussion.
Yes, Barry.
I mean, obviously, it's the right thing to do. If we are obligated to deliver a certain water pressure to everybody here. The only thing that I would maybe question in this motion, and is that what I would hate to see is that someone just sort of picking this up is just saying, "Oh, the town has just, you know, bought a, you know, something to boost the water pressure up. You know, maybe I can go to the town for something." If we're obligated to do it, we would do it. The only thing maybe I would amend the motion is to say, and I don't know if this would be appropriate, but to say that move of the Board of Selectmen, acting in their role as Water and Sewer Commissioners, being obligated to have whatever the pounds per, however it's measured, so that basically it would prevent somebody from coming in and just saying, "Well, I'd like my water pressure to be higher. You did it for this person." So, you know, if the standard is, you know, pound, I don't know about how it's measured, but to just to say, you know, to maintain the minimum of da da da.
So are you offering a friendly amendment?
Well, very friendly amendment.
Let me ask, did town council seem to think that that was implied clearly enough that there is a standard?
He did, and I think coupled with the fact that in the surveying of the department in 40 years, this is the first request that's come in front of him. But
really? Okay.
No, Barry's point is well taken in the sense that, gee, I think I have low water pressure, come on out and measure. Well,
right.
If anyone's going to ask, we're going to go out and measure. It doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
But the threshold is so low that, you know, if you think you have low water pressure, you don't.
Right.
You would know.
But apparently it was in this case.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And that makes sense to do it, but it just kind of just, it sort of, it brackets kind of what people can come. And again, I don't know, I would offer it specifically, but I don't know what the minimum is.
You know, I think the implication that according to town council is strong enough. I do take your point. If this becomes an epidemic, we may come back to you with some ideas.
Yeah. I mean, certainly we want it. We want to make sure that the newcomers to our town can take a shower. I mean, that's
basically what it was.
Mm. Yeah. So obviously we want to do the right thing there, but I just worry on things like this of, you know, what, sometimes it's gray, what's the town's responsibility, what a homeowner's responsibility is, and obviously we'll always err on the side of doing the right thing, but, you know, I'd want to just make the motion tight enough so that it doesn't give somebody an idea that they can come here and, you know, do something that we don't necessarily obligate to do.
So you are also citing a specific address, so it may be argued it's a precedent,
okay. Yep.
But
okay.
It's not a policy.
Yeah. So do you have an amendment? What's your amendment, or are you not going to make one?
You know, for the sake of just moving things along, I think I won't make the amendment, but I just wanted just to kind of bring up that concern that I had about setting precedent, not just on water, but, you know, on anything else, services. I mean, obviously there's a minimum expectation of all the services that we deliver, especially that we're charging for. So, you know, this is kind of, you know, doing something for somebody that could get interpreted as, well, they got it, why can't I?
Well, in full disclosure, town council being town council, he said, my first preference is the selectmen create a new policy. I said, that'll be fine, but these people will have moved out of
right
by then.
Amendment withdrawn.
So you should put on your to-do list, and I'll help you when you're talking about selectmen's policies, is this needs to be a policy.
Sure. And that is, you know, that's going to be a irksome task and weighty responsibility.
Yeah.
Moving through all of those policies,
right. Oh, yeah.
But they do need to be addressed, and we can include that as we go along.
Town council was really surprised that in Reading's history, when you set water and sewer rates, that you don't also have a motion that discusses abatement policy. He said, you're the only town I know that doesn't do it that way, so you will next year.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's fine.
All right.
Any other discussion on the motion? And then I'm assuming that you're to let it go the way it is.
Yeah.
Okay, all those in favor of the motion? Opposed?
All right.
4-0.
Get your guys.
Bob, what else do you have?
Nothing else, thank you.
So we're about to have a crowd for our next proclamation here.
This could become a more apropos time.
This is standard fare now.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Okay, this is a proclamation for National Police Week. Whereas emergencies can occur at any time that require the police, and whereas when an emergency occurs, the prompt response of police officers is critical to the protection of life and preservation of property, and whereas the safety of our police officers is dependent upon the quality and accuracy of information obtained from citizens who telephone the Reading Public Safety Communications Center, and whereas Reading police officers are a crucial contact point between our citizens and emergency services, and whereas the May 15th is National Peace Officer Memorial Day, honoring those men and women who gave the ultimate sacrifice, and whereas police officers of the Reading Police Department have contributed substantially to the prevention of crime and the apprehension of criminals and play an essential role in safeguarding the rights and freedoms of Reading citizens, and whereas members of the Reading Police Department exhibit compassion, understanding, and the highest standards of professionalism in the performance of their jobs, and now, therefore, we, the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading, Massachusetts, do hereby proclaim the week of May 15th through May 21st, 2016, as National Police Week in the Town of Reading, in honor of the men and women whose dedication and professionalism keep our towns and citizens safe.
And do I have a second to that proclamation?
Well, there's a real motion to be read there.
Oh.
That puts that into effect.
Move that the Board of Selectmen proclaim May 15th to May 21st, 2016, as National Police Week in the Town of Reading.
Second.
All those in favor?
Before you do that,
yes,
I'd like to make a comment. I'd like to thank our officers for all they do in this town. And I'd like to maybe make a plea to higher levels of government folks who are governors and mayors of major cities to kind of put down this business about judging actions of police in the heat of car chases. The incident in New Hampshire particularly galled me, the way that was handled by the governor up there. I just want to let you folks know you have my full-throated support. That the gentleman, and I'll use that term advisedly, almost hit a small child on that dead-end street where he was finally caught. I would have been pretty charged up myself, I think, if I'd been on the scene. So I'll just ask that you let our folks in blue do their job at the higher level. Stop the nonsense. And thank you for all you do.
Any other discussion or comment? You guys do a fabulous job in this town, and I said it about fire a little earlier today, and I will say it about you. And it's everything from the challenges that you guys have faced in the last 90 days are kind of spectacular, really, and you just have done, you know, yeoman's work. And it's from that all the way down to on my way to work every day today down Lowell Street, making sure that everything's flowing and working. I mean, you guys really take care of it all. And I want to go along with what Dan is saying and just tell you how important you are to us and how much we appreciate you. This proclamation, is kind of a way to let you know that officially, but in an unofficial way, I think, I hope you know you have all of our support and gratitude.
Thank you. Yeah. Mr. Chairman, Board, we really appreciate and value your support. Thank you for allowing us to be up here tonight in front of you. It is National Police Week. So far this year, 35 officers have been killed in the line of duty as of today, 17 by gunfire this year, which is up 55% from last year. And most of these are in smaller communities. They're not in the big city. A lot of these are happening in places like Reading across the country. So we really do appreciate your support. We know you have us. And again, I want to say, well, thank you to all my officers for being here tonight and for being familiar. Thank you.
Thank you. And who can we present this?
Actually, we have to take the vote.
Oh, we have to take a vote? See, I don't have this chairman thing on very well yet. I'll get to it, though. All those in favor of this proclamation? No opposition?
No.
That carries 4-0. And we need to make this presentation.
Chief?
I think make it to the chief.
Sure.
Thank you, Chief. Appreciation.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Chief.
Gentlemen, thank you. Yeah.
Good job.
Thank you, gentlemen. Yes, could I ask for one second? I have the officer come up here and take one picture with us.
Sure.
Oh, absolutely.
Please,
yeah.
Please do.
Yep.
You'll notice the Red Sox also recognized the Reading Police.
Yes, they did. I should have brought
that.
That's
oh, excellent.
Yeah, they are at Fenway.
Fantastic.
We should get out of the way. Or sit down or something.
Yes, we're part of the infrastructure, I guess.
You think? This thing you guys are doing.
Bring it.
Great.
Detail. Right. Face. Forward. March.
Couldn't get the bagpipes, huh, Chief?
Present. Pumps.
Thanks again to all of you.
Thank you.
One down.
Okay. So Jeff, what do you got in store for us?
A proclamation.
Where are your guys? Guys. That's where the bagpipes are coming from.
A couple of guys with shovels are on the way, right?
Okay, this all is
here, you're rolling.
Proclamation, National Public Works Week. Whereas public works services provided in our community are an integral but often unnoticed part of our residents' everyday lives, and whereas the support and support of understanding and informed residents is vital to the efficient operation of public works programs such as water, sewers, streets, highways, parks, and forestry, and solid waste collection, and whereas the health, safety, and comfort of residents this community depends on these facilities and services, and whereas the quality and effectiveness of these services is vitally dependent upon the efforts and skill of public work officials and employees, and whereas the efficiency of the qualified and dedicated personnel who staff our public works department is materially influenced by the residents' attitude and understanding of the importance of the work they perform, and now, therefore, we, the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading, Massachusetts, does hereby proclaim the week of May 15th to May 21st, 2016, as Public Works Week in the Town of Reading, and we call upon all residents and civic organizations to acquaint themselves with the issues involved in providing quality public works services to this community and to recognize the contributions which public works officials and employees make every day to our health, safety, comfort, and quality of life. Move that the Board of Selectmen proclaim the week of May 15th to May 21st, 2016 as Public Works Week in the Town of Reading.
Seconded.
And any discussion or comment?
Well, I'll praise these guys too. And you can
roll tonight, Dan.
Yeah, I was thinking about this and I'm saying you can get through as an average citizen Reading a day without interacting with you know, public services, with the police and the fire. If you don't have kids in school, the school department, but I guarantee you can't get through a day without touching public works in some form or fashion, through the waters, use of the road, and you guys have been doing a much improved job on our roads. That's appreciated. The priority is getting there. We apologize, you know, we're getting there on the tearing up the streets, but I think it's being better coordinated now. So thanks for all you guys do. And maybe next year we'll have a Friends of Public Works to sit out here on the pews.
So, we need to vote.
Need to vote. Yeah.
All those in favor?
Yep. Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I'd just take 1 second. I appreciate
sure.
it.
Please do.
To recognize all the good work we've done. I think recently in the paper, I think maybe you've noticed that the town did get an award for water quality and water service.
Yep.
Actually,
yep.
We got two awards, which is really unusual.
We're enjoying them now.
One for a water conservation program, and the other for just water operations. This is the 30 in a row we received the Water Operations Award. And a lot of factors go into that, but let me just give you one example. The standard for loss of water within the community is roughly 10%. That's kind of like a guide that DEP uses. The gold standard is like around 5% of water loss in the community. That means you're really doing the right things through replacement of capital improvements and doing I&I work and so forth. Well, Town of Reading was 1.5%.
Oh, that's
wow.
Awesome.
Which is, and we track every drop
amazing.
Of water we put into our sweeping machine, every time we do a water flushing program, we measure it so we know where all our water goes, and so we know, therefore, our unaccounted for water is so low, it's really a standard in the state. So that's one of the factors that goes into that award, which is really, I thought, was worth mentioning.
Yeah, absolutely.
It certainly is.
The other thing I'd like to do is just introduce our new town engineer. I think some of the board members have
yes.
maybe met Ryan Percival. He's actually been here a week officially as a town engineer. Ryan went to a Merrimack College degree in engineering. He's been with the town for 11 years. He came in as a young man. Well, he still is a young man.
He'll leave as an old man.
He's younger than some.
Is he in diapers,
like?
he came in, and he's been here 11 years. He started as an assistant civil engineer, moved up to civil engineer, got his PE, moved up to senior civil engineer, and really has a great background. I think the town is going to be really well served. We've got some things, plans for engineering now, that things are moving forward, we're really happy with. I would like to take this opportunity to thank George Stamboros, who's retiring, been with the town for 10 years. I wish him good luck in his retirement, good health, and but we're moving forward with a new regime, so I think, again, I'm very, I look forward to working with Ryan, very happy that this has happened.
Great, thanks.
Welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Ryan's first Board of Selectmen meeting was in North Reading to talk about water.
That's right.
Thank you, Rudy. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you.
Yep.
Appreciate it.
I've seen you with the orange vests out there, Ryan.
Yeah. Up there, moving target.
Nice to meet you.
Congratulations.
Glad to have you on board.
Congratulations on your position.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks. Good luck.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Rolling.
Okay.
Hey. Well, you're on a roll.
You're on a roll, Barry.
Is this one?
Another one.
Oh, okay. Okay, this is a proclamation for Walk Reading Weekend. Whereas research shows that 1 in 2 men and 1 in 3 women are at risk for heart disease with poor lifestyles as a major contributor, and whereas adults may gain up to 2 hours of life expectancy for every hour of regular vigorous exercise, and whereas regular exercise has many proven benefits for an individual's overall health in addition to increased life expectancy, and whereas walking, running, and bicycling are all excellent forms of exercise that are accessible to most of our citizens, that help the environment by reducing the use of motorized transport, and that allow our citizens to appreciate and learn about our neighborhoods and the open spaces in our community. And whereas the Reading Trails Committee, the Reading Open Land Trust, and Walkable Reading encourage all Reading residents to participate in Walk Reading Weekend on Saturday, June 4th and 5th, 2016, by getting outside and taking a walk, bike, hike, or run. Now therefore we, the Selectmen of the Town of Reading, in recognition of the importance of regular physical activity to promote individual and community health, and to reduce greenhouse emission, do hereby proclaim June 4th and 5th, 2016 as Walk Reading Weekend, and urge all citizens to show their support for this effort by walking, biking, running, or hiking here in town on at least one of those days. Move that the Board of Selectmen proclaim June 4th and 5th, 2016 as Walk Reading Weekend in the town of Reading.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? Here we go. Okay. All those in favor of this proclamation? Opposed? 4-0, Paul. Mm-hmm.
Is there
somebody to accept this today? Great.
Yeah,
Will Finch.
Will Finch, I'm with the Reading Trails Committee.
Thanks, Will.
I'll be leading one of the walks.
A new
trail we just inaugurated from Cottage Drive over to Charles Street.
That's great, and we'll hear more about that in your report later, is that right?
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Yeah. Okay, I think it's time for us to move on to a continued hearing. I don't think we've got a.
We don't have to read the notice.
Just declare it open again. Yep.
Continued, and this is regarding the liquor license application for the Art Lounge on Haven Street. And I think in our packets we have.
Necessary
information.
I consider this, as much as any continued hearing, a formality.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. The applicant has endured several hundred hours so far.
Yes, yes.
And finally reached the limit. this is the plan that
Judy... put them on early in the agenda. They don't have to sit here all night.
Well, we tried. This is the plan that Judy submitted at your last meeting, but it was just an hour or two before the meeting. As we all expected, the building inspector looked at it and was fine. She's got the proper clearances for handicapped accessibility. So everything is ready to go on this one.
Excellent.
Great.
So, close the hearing.
First of all, any discussion, any questions for the applicants? Any comments that the applicants would like to make? You've had enough, huh? When will you open?
Talking to the contractors today. So,
since we are in a hearing, a public hearing, I'd like to open this to any public comment. Hearing none. I would, first of all, entertain a motion to close the hearing. I think that's the right order.
Correct. Yeah.
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the application for a wine and malt general on-premise liquor license for the Art Lounge on Haven, 78 Haven Street.
Oh, that's part of the name. I get it.
Yeah. Okay. Seconded.
Any discussion on the closing the hearing? All those in favor? Opposed? 4-0. And now we'll entertain a motion regarding the license.
Move that the Board of Selectmen find that a wine and malt general on-premise liquor license for the Art Lounge LLC does serve a public need, and there are sufficient remaining unused licenses for anticipated economic development of future restaurant businesses. Move that the Board of Selectmen approve a new wine and malt general on-premise liquor license for the Art Lounge LLC, DBA, the Art Lounge on Haven, 78 Haven Street, for a term expiring December 31st, 2016, subject to the following conditions. All bylaws, rules, and regulations of the Town of Reading and of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts shall be followed and subject to a satisfactory inspection of the establishment by the town manager or his designee.
I'll second.
Discussion?
Happy to approve this. I think we've had a lot of good process and discussion on the subject.
Yep. A lot of work's gone into it from all sides, particularly from the applicant. All those in favor? Opposed?
Congratulations.
Good luck.
Thank you to the board. Thank you to the panel.
And I think, yeah, we're actually running just a little behind. We're sorry about that. The Climate Advisory Committee is here to visit with us.
Ron?
Yes, please. So it'd be good for the record to both introduce yourselves, and on we go.
I'm Ron DiDario, President Chair of the Climate Committee, and
David Z. Member of the committee.
A new member of the committee, and just a great asset. I'm really thankful to have David with us. First of all, I'm just going to hit a down arrow here, just when I want it to go. Oh, just click there. Okay. Can you go back just a sec?
Oh, now you're going to make it.
Okay. Can you go back? All right. Thanks, Bob. First of all, thank you for having us here. We're really grateful. First of all, I want to say that our logo is from Michelle Benson. She's no longer with us, but she does participate a bit. And that Laurianne Sylvia, one of our members who works for the RMLD, actually put together this presentation. So I'd like to just give her a little praise. Also, in starting off, I want to thank particularly the Board of Selectmen for supporting us, and particularly Danny and Barry, just because they actually came to a couple of our meetings and helped us to work out a few things. And of course, Bob, who's always available and always gives us his time, so thank you. Our members, we do have a full group right now, although some of us are coming up for, we're actually going to be stepping down. Joan Bogle has been our secretary for, I don't know, maybe 3 years. She's done a great job, and she's going to be stepping down at that. I'll be stepping down as chair as well. We try to rotate the chair every year. And you can see Dave's actually a full voting member. On our associates, Jeffrey Everson is also a new member with us. And of course, I think most of you have seen Gina Snyder's name around. She's really an icon when it comes to environmental work. Our mission statement is, basically we're volunteers, and our job is really to achieve environmental, economic, and societal sustainability by raising public awareness, influencing the community, including the government, to reduce energy use and foster environmental stewardship in a cost-effective manner. Some of the educational and community outreach that we did this past year, our Green Sense article goes into the Advocate and the Chronicle, and Gina Snyder takes it on herself. She's responsible to it. Occasionally, some of our members contribute, but she's basically the person who she this with a ball stop. She makes sure that an article gets in, and to her credit, she's never missed. And probably 4 or 5 years. So God bless her. The other thing, we've had a bit of outreach to Reading Senior Center, and on December 7th, we, the Climate Committee, along with the RMLD, visited the Senior Center, working with the Council on Aging and with Jane Burns. And this is actually Gina's idea. We were working with the Council on Aging to encourage our seniors to utilize the free energy audits available from RMLD, and we also were trying to provide them with financial assistance to incorporate some of the recommendations from that audit. So what we were doing, in order to help them with the audit, we, the Climate Committee and the Council on Aging, we agreed that if they needed help, we would help them with the application, which is one phone call, and we would also be in their home. Some people, if they were a little afraid of having someone come into the house for an audit, we would go to the house, be with them.
Right.
And maybe even interpret the results, you know, when you come up with the results. So, and we also worked with a couple of the banks, and I think we told you that before. So, and we had two banks interested in helping us financially, and we were kind of moving on, and then we did come up with a little blockage where Bob kind of thought that we had to be a little careful on how we solicit funds and how we get donations,
yeah.
And thought that we had to have town council's advice on how we proceed. So we put a stop to that as far as the financial end. We're waiting council's decision. But in the meantime, we are offering the seniors, it just went out in their newsletter, where the Climate Committee is offering to help them with the application and help them to be at their home. So at least we can get the audit done. And then possibly later we might be able to have some funds to help them out. Normally we've been to the high school on several occasions to give, we give presentations, basically PowerPoints. We've done that almost every year. This year we haven't visited the high school, but we did visit one fifth grade class at Birch Meadow Elementary School for a little talk on climate change. And one of the parents, Gigliotti. He helped with the presentation, so we did that kind of in unison. We had Earth Day, April 23rd at the RMLD, and Laurie-Anne Sylvia did a lot of work in organizing and doing the logistics. We had a bunch of people come inside the RMLD. We had different providers for solar voltaic heat pumps, which might be the next thing now, you know, electric heat pumps to take the place of maybe oil heat. That could be what's coming. It's already here, but it might take off. And then geothermal sources of alternative energy as well. Ray Porter, one of our members, has actually geothermal in his home here on Franklin Street. You might have seen it.
I've been in that home.
You've been in the house.
Yeah.
So
I was curious when he was putting it in. I wanted to see what kind of system he had.
Well,
it's pretty impressive, actually.
The main idea in geothermal, shortly, is if you go underground like 10 feet, the temperature is like 54 degrees all the time. So he goes way down, like goes way down, maybe 400 feet.
Yeah.
But when that fluid comes back, let's say it's 54 degrees. So if you are trying to raise your heat to 68, now you're at, this comes in at 64, just to pump it through.
Yep.
Okay? It could be 20 degrees outside, but that liquid that's coming up is 54. So it helps you to get to that point. And the same way for air conditioning, that's 54 degrees when it's 95. So that's kind of a little bit how geothermal works. Other geothermal is when you live in Iceland and you got steam coming right out of the ground.
Right.
That's something else. Now, so far, we haven't had any steam eruptions in Reading that I know of. A
few gas leaks.
Few gas leaks. Now, if we could get that methane, that's another way. Anyway, so also we had RMLD also presented their audits and rebate offers, etc. And then we ended up outside, we had five cars there. We ended up with a i3 BMW all electric. That's a Lercar all electric, a Ford Fusion plug-in hybrid. We ended up with a Tesla. The second one from the right is actually a Tesla S. And the one to extreme right is a Ford, Chevrolet Volt. So we had a they were interesting to see these cars together. Plus, we had about three salesmen there representing the different cars. And I think actually one Tesla S may have been sold on site. No, it wasn't me. but that car that was on site was like $135,000. And you might have heard that Tesla now has a $35,000 car that they put out that's all electric and has a range of over 200 miles on a charge. So I'm hoping that one Earth Day, that maybe I could see one of you there, drop by to say hello, and we could show you what's going on. We also do adopt an island, and Ray Porter and his wife Mary, who is sort of into gardening and landscape, have done a lot of job, as well as Gina and Joan, and David Williams, one of our former members as well. We're trying to get our site up to par. Next, I'm going to let David step in because he was really responsible for working and getting Brad Jones to come, and he can maybe talk on that a little better than I can.
A couple topic here. The committee sponsored a community meeting with Representative Bradley Jones in March, the end of March, and there were about 20 people there, about 20 community members. Dan was there and Bob was there, so we really appreciated having you two there. At the time, Bradley Jones was a member of a conference committee that was reconciling two solar energy bills, one from the House, one from the Senate, and so it was a very topical. Then he talked a lot about the energy bills, and so did the community members. Since that time, the conference committee finished their bill, and it was passed by the legislature. It doubled the cap on net metering and laid out some of the other conditions for what could be reimbursed. The other thing that Representative Jones talked about was the what he called the Comprehensive Energy Bill, or which is often referred to as the Omnibus Energy Bill, which is about to come before the legislature. It has not been written up and released yet. It'll probably come out last week of May, first week of June maybe, but which is a bill that's going to lay out what the Massachusetts energy future really is, what kind of energy we're going to get, where we're going to get it from. So it's a very important bill, and Representative Jones was extremely knowledgeable about that on that topic, and is knowledgeable on that topic. So we were glad to have him, and everybody was really appreciative of his coming, and he was very engaging. I thought it was a super successful meeting. So, also want to tell you, to give you a little update on the gas leaks. So this is the gas leaks issue that we've talked about for some time. 20,000 gas leaks at the end of 2014, including 114 in Reading. And there were two laws that were proposed to address that. There were 32, it says 31 here, but that was last week. There are 32 municipalities that, including Reading, that have passed resolutions in support of these bills, representing about 30% of the population of Massachusetts. Reading was the 22nd to do so. I really appreciate that support from the Selectmen. Where we are now, the 2870, which was the bill to not allow utilities to charge customers for leaking natural gas, that bill was sent by the Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy Committee to study, so that's going nowhere this session. That's dead at this point. The other one, 2871, which requires the gas companies to repair leaks when a road is open for some other purpose, yep, that one is currently in the Senate Ways and Means Committee. It's probably, you know, it's going to be there while they do the Omnibus Energy Bill and while they do the budget, and then it may have a chance to come out. But so it's still up for this year. That's overall pretty good news. But I also brought along these little tiny numbers in the corner there to tell you what's transpired since. So in March, data for 2015 was released. Gas leaks data for 2015 was released. And you can see where it starts out. This shows number of leaks at the beginning of the year and number of leaks at the end of the year. So in Reading, we started 2015 with 91 gas leaks and ended the year with 94 gas leaks. So we're actually, and this is not unusual. In the overall, Massachusetts, we're up about 2,700 gas leaks in 2015. In the national grids area, about 1,300 gas leaks increase. Notice also that of the gas leaks that appeared, new leaks, last year in Reading, 25 of 44 were the grade one, which are the dangerous leaks. Mm-hmm. So what that says, I believe, is that our system is falling apart faster than we can fix it, that our natural gas system is actually beyond decrepit, and the only thing that's really going to fix it is replacement of antiquated gas lines with new lines. On the other hand, there is some good news in that Boston University did some testing and found that some 7% of the gas leaks produce 50% of the leaks present 50% of the emission. So there is an opportunity to find the bad actors and fix those and fix the problem.
Well, could I make a comment? Sure. Your figures more or less show the category one and two are the worst, right?
Category one is to fix it right now. Category two is fix it within 12 months.
Of the new leaks, all were fixed, and of the in the category one.
Mm-hmm.
And in category two, 14 of 15. And where we seem to not be keeping up is category three, which that's the kind of can damage trees in the long term, but they're not posing an imminent danger. So it looks like we're taking care in Reading of the most serious.
Well, so the law requires that they fix the grade one leaks
right now,
immediately. That was a 2014 law, right. And yes, and it's been these grade three leaks that have been accumulating.
Right.
So because they don't have to be fixed, and it's grade three leaks that are causing the, that's just the emissions.
Well, to say our system's falling apart may be a bit of a stretch.
Well, what I'm saying is, there are more gas leaks appeared in 2015 than were fixed. So that's not making progress. To say that we had most of our gas leak that appeared last year were the most dangerous kind says to me that we're not winning this battle yet. Right.
It's a good thing we fixed them, but they did happen.
They did happen. Yeah.
Okay.
There was also some anomaly here. You may notice that we ended 2014 with 114 gas leaks, but started 2015 with 91. So there are some 23 gas leaks that were written off the books over New Year's Eve on the night of December 31st, 2014. There are about 6,000 gas leaks across the state of Massachusetts that were removed from the list. And
so you're saying they weren't fixed, but they were removed?
They were just taken off. They were on a list of gas leaks that were known and documented and everything. They were on the maps that you saw, with the gas leaks, and they were simply taken off. There were, and so some of those, like I said, about 23 of those in Reading. It's not at all obvious why that is. But
did anybody reach out to find out why that was?
Yes. They've done a couple of. There were a couple of stories about that. One was that they were duplicates, and there were duplicates.
Okay.
The other one is that they put in a gas main and fixed a whole bunch of leaks at once, and so they just eliminate them. But actually, the blue bubbles here are the gas leaks that were taken off the list in Reading. And I have trouble seeing how these are duplicates or, in some sense, the result of replacing a gas main. They're just kind of sprinkled all over the place. The testing, there's been some testing done of about something under 100 of these missing gas leaks, and gas was found at two-thirds of them. So, we're talking actually to, not this committee, but other people are talking to National Grid and Eversource about what's going on here. But aside from that, aside from that kind of bookkeeping and why those disappeared, of the ones that we were counting, we were still increasing the number of gas leaks in 2015. So it's still very much an issue, and it's still timely.
You back to the picture with the balloons.
Oops, Riley.
Yeah. Of the yellow, how many of those are, category one, two, and three? Is the predominant, are they mostly in one, mostly in two, mostly in three?
They're here.
Well, that's the new. That's the new ones.
This picture is the end of 2015 map, but also showing the blues that were taken out at the beginning of the year.
But the ones unrepaired, the breakdown between one, two, and three, that's cumulative over time, not that.
No, this is a snapshot
at
the end of the year, and this is the snapshot data. So there were no ones So at the end of the year, ending 0193. So
it shouldn't be that bottom line.
Oh, okay, got it. Yeah, that's it. Yep.
So that's that's the end of 2015.
So most of those yellows are category three.
Yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Okay. I mean that. I mean they're fixing the. If they identify as a serious leak, they're fixing the leak.
Okay.
No, no question. Any other? Thank you.
Okay, to give you a little idea of what's in the works, we are, the Climate Committee is reevaluating its action plan, and we're using the LEAP study that was done for our RMLD, and I momentarily forgot the what LEAP actually stands for. I apologize for that. But that was a study that was done by the MAPC and to help Reading for efficiency and all kinds of things. It was not adopted by RMLD, but it has an awful lot of things in it. Part of it is like community solar and things of that nature that we are going to use that as a basis, because it does have not everything, but a lot of it in there is good stuff. We also hope in talking and reviewing our action plan, maybe to talk to you guys and get some input and say, I'm not sure, I know, I think Barry was our liaison, and I'm not sure if that is remains or not, but in any...
I'm not, are you?
Yeah. In any case,
we just changed it.
So maybe during our time of reevaluating our action plan, we would like to be more in sync with the selectmen. We are advisors to you,
right?
And we'd like to advise you on things that,
sure.
I mean, there's a lot of interesting gas leaks, and that may be something we could keep you abreast of,
yep.
Or something like that. And maybe other things. We are working with RMLD a bit on community solar, and we are meeting with them at a board meeting on June 9th. And we're trying, they're having a little trouble with community solar. They came, tried to sell it to us here. I know the high school got involved and it got tangled up. but they went to Wilmington, they had a little bit more of a green light, and then there were some problems there. So our goal, maybe, if possible, with some kind of good liaison, to reintroduce that to Reading, to see if maybe we can make it work by keeping all parties informed up to date, so we don't end up with confusion and, you know, where things get kind of messed up because one side doesn't know what the other side is doing. Maybe the Climate Committee could be kind of a middleman to keep everybody informed and everybody on the same page, so that possibly that could reemerge. We're also looking in a way, and this is kind of really difficult, is how do you get, like, we're looking to improve solar, not only community solar, but solar on homes. That's a very tricky issue.
Right.
Tricky issue is that, well, if you think about it, the more individuals you have solar panels, in a sense, it cuts down on income to RMLD.
Correct. Yeah.
So, but we also know, and if you're reading the news, if you've listen to the Paris COP21 climate summit at the end of the year. There was a big climate summit. The world participates. I mean, you can even look at the Pope's encyclical on the environment. We know we have to get off fossil fuel. I mean, the point is that we don't want the climate to go above 2 degrees centigrade. We're already at 1 degree centigrade. That's 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. We don't want to go above 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit. And we've got a limited time to get that done. So we have to go to alternative energy. So what we're looking at, and myself in particular, is how do we change the paradigm for RMLD so they make money when they do solar? And I'm not claiming I have a way to do that, but there has to be a way. There has to be a way to move to make it profitable for our energy provider to go to solar, to go to whatever form of alternative energy, and to get us off of fossil fuel. We are also working with the Council on Aging. We're trying to go forward with assisting our seniors, and hopefully we can get some financial aid. We like very much what David Zeke did with Brad Jones and bringing him here, and we hadn't done that before, and we're looking to say maybe we could do more of that to get people coming in. Danny?
Just to inject a point on the community solar. David, maybe you can help me with this one. I think part of the problem we had before was kind of the flux of vendors in and out of the market. We didn't know who was going to be in business 2 months from now, 3 months from now. Now, did this recent action by the legislature fix the net metering issue to the point where it's now more of a predictable stream of of money coming back to people that invest in solar? Do you think that's helping with the community?
It is, but we're going to hit the new limit this year.
Oh, even the new one that
the one that they just passed may even be hit before the session expires.
Bob mentioned a 1 year bridge.
That's the most it will be.
So there was a pent up queue of projects that wanted to move forward, and they kind of all rushed forward.
That didn't satisfy the
demand. No.
How about the reimbursement to the residents? Was that increase, decrease, kept about the same?
It was for a typical homeowner, it's the same. For municipalities, it's the same, which is to say a retail price.
This is the write-down you get on your electric bill from putting solar converted AC back into the grid.
For users, people who use a little more, maybe commercial operations, it was reduced. Now, RMLD, kind of, because it's a community organization, it operates under a different set of rules, so they set their own. And RMLD reimburses close to the wholesale rate, the production rate.
Okay.
So
they're not reimbursing as greatly
as generously as the law allows. Yeah. Or says. Yeah.
So there might be some, there might be something in the middle. Usually it goes, it's wholesale or retail. Mm-hmm. It's too high or too low. So maybe there's something in the middle, and then there's also the SREX that could come in.
Explain those to the folks.
Well, basically, it's. Renewable energy, an SREC is something for every so much that our our investor operated utilities have to purchase so much renewable energy,
right.
And a certain percentage of that has to be solar. And those RECs, renewable energy certificates, SRECs are just solar renewable energy certificates. They call SRECs. For example, you have an energy provider that has to get 5% solar. They need 5% solar. So if I have solar in my home, for so many thousand kilowatts, I get maybe an SREC.
Right.
I can sell that to them. And right now the market is like, I think Dave may know better, but it's over $200 like for one SREC. Okay, now. The question comes, in the municipalities, does like RMLD, they may have in contract that all SRECs go to them.
Okay.
So it's complicated because RMLD is also looking to survive. They also have the mandate to provide the lowest cost energy to the four communities. They don't want a community to leave them. Okay? So it's not easy to do. It's complicated. But the bottom line is, we have to do it. We have to move off of fossil fuel, and we have to be creative, and it has to be kind of a win-win situation to some extent. So that RMLD, we all depend on electricity.
Yeah.
And if the sun isn't shining, we don't want the breathing machine to suddenly turn off. So we all know that it's important. The question is, how do we do it? And right now with electric cars, it could be a lot more electricity sold to RMLD if we start going electric. So there could be more sales. They could actually perhaps install solar. They could be solar providers. So there's ways to do it, but it's not easy to change course of when you're on the Titanic. It's hard. Okay. So. We're looking to do a little more with Earth Day, to educate, encourage, etc., and I'll offer educational programs to our schools and any other organization that might want somebody to come with a a presentation on energy efficiency and energy conservation. So I would just like to end and say, first of all, thank you to listen. I hope we weren't too long, and I apologize if we were. And I would just say, if you could, in everything you do, to remember, like, that one plastic bottle is actually, you're holding oil in your hand, that plastic bottle. So in everything you do, although it's, you've got your few, many practical things you do to keep this town running, to always, in the back of your head, keep in mind that the state is looking to go in 2020 to make a 25% reduction of 1990 emissions. That's their legal goal. So we can all work with them. That everything you do, just maybe run the energy. Is there a way we could save energy? Is there a way we can save resources? Can we get recycling going a little better? Especially like in the McDonald's and all our fast food places and restaurants, mm-hmm. where most of the stuff is just trash. Thank you. We appreciate your time and wish you success.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
You guys thank work you. Hard at it.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob.
I think the Trails Committee has a report for us.
Would you mind popping that onto the laptop just so we have it, whatever you're doing?
Okay, I'd get it in there. Okay. Yeah. Well, the simplest thing.
While we're getting settled, we got a little note. Apparently, the server for RCTV crashed in the middle of this, so we went from live to black for a while. So I'm fairly certain we're back live again. So for anybody that might be watching on TV, that's what happened. Everything will be available on YouTube. You know. Following this, so anything that you wanted to watch, you know, from the comfort of your home, you'll be able to revisit sometime, probably by the end of the week. But in the meantime, we're going to continue, and if the Trails Committee would introduce themselves for the record and proceed.
Okay. Hi, I'm Tom Gadd. I'm the trail chair of the Trails Committee.
Good.
Will Finn's another member.
Hi, Will.
And probably another member.
Okay.
Kim Hodgson,
the
GIS administrator.
You're driving tonight, huh?
I am driving.
Okay. You do the best job of anybody driving that thing.
We shall see.
Where we at?
Okay.
Okay. You're on.
Okay. The Trails Committee was formed in 2008 as an outgrowth of the Northern Greenway, and their plan was to build a trail all the way from basically Route 93 to Haverhill Street. And that's mostly done. There's a few gaps, especially Route 28. And so citizens of the town got together and said, this is a good idea, why don't we keep it going? So they went to the town, and the town said, okay, we'll have the Trails Committee. And they told the Trails Committee we wanted to build new trails, maintain the existing trails, and also set standards for the trails that are out there. Because up to that point, everything was hodgepodge. Everybody thought, this is a good trail, that's a good trail. Wasn't a good idea. So we have standardized the trails, which makes it much easier for planning and maintenance. You know what we expect. The trails are going to be 3 feet wide, 4 feet wide, pressure-treated lumber, treks on top, certain substructure, and that's how we go about doing it now. Okay, so anyway, since then, we've done projects mostly, every conservation area in the town. We've done projects in the town forest, Hurricane Woods, Bear Meadow, Sledge Woods, Higgins, Pineville, and Evergreen. I'm attempting to give every part of the town a trail, or some way to get out and enjoy what Reading has to offer, and there's a lot to be offered in Reading. When it comes to conservation areas. And just in the last year and a half, we've been involved in many projects. The Conservation Commission gave us permission to do 5 projects in the Bear Meadow area, of which we've completed 4. We built three bridges, and we raised one of the trails 4 to 6 inches using pack. Because after the winter of 15, which everyone tries to forget, it was very wet. So we had to raise the trail because at one point it was impassable out in Bear Meadow. You couldn't walk. So we put a drain in and we raised the trail. And we're going to build the next bridge, one more bridge to build, and that's going to be done on June 11th. And we're looking for volunteers for June 11th if anybody wants to come and help us.
Are you asking the scouts? That could be a great Eagle project.
Scouts do a lot of Eagle projects for us.
That's how they used to do them. I think they've morphed a bit from conservation.
They still do.
That's the town day too, right? June 11th. I think there's going to be a lot going on in town that day.
Wow. We don't need just an hour or two. You can spare to come out and give us a hand. We appreciate any help we can get. We also repaired the bridge over in Higgins Conservation Area. It was missing decking, and we repaired that because a lot of the kids in that neighborhood use that bridge to get to school. It's a cut through. And we cleared trees, up to 30 trees were knocked down, so we cleared the trees from the trails that year. And we also had to replace 85 to 100 stainless steel rods in the viewing platform material. It was either vandalism, and I do not believe it was vandalism. I think someone stole those rods. Literally went up to the viewing platform and took the stainless steel rods.
Rods that hold it up?
Do you want me to catch up with the images?
You got a picture?
We do.
It was.
There we go.
We're using those stainless steel rods as balusters, so the kids can't fall off the platform.
Right. But they can see through them.
They can see through them. But someone went and took 85 to 100 of those. Just whatever reason.
A guy who walks his dog up there frequently gave us the money to replace the steel rods. He approached the committee, so that was really nice.
And we modified the design so that they're tougher than possible to steal to get out.
Hopefully.
Oh, they've been there about at least a year, I think.
Well, they were there for a while before. Anyhow, that's basically the only real act of vandalism we've encountered in the 7-8 years we've been around. And I don't think it was vandalism. I think somebody stole them. Anyhow. And we just finished the newest trail, the Evergreen Trail, and that connects Cowie Drive to Chow Street. So now that part of town has a trail in a conservation area they can go in.
Can you show the map of that?
Yeah.
Imagine that.
Oh, yeah. There it is.
Okay,
you can see where it starts at Cowie Drive.
Yep.
There.
It goes all the way over to Chow Street.
So when you say you completed the trail,
okay,
tell me what that, I envision, you know, pickaxes and shovels and chopping trees.
Okay, the Evergreen Trail, it was basically there. We just took the vegetation back, we blazed it, we put white blazing on the trees, white marking on the trees so people can find their way through because people do get lost. It was an existing trail, we just bring it back up to standards.
How long is our trail?
How long?
Half mile?
Probably not even that, maybe a quarter mile.
Quarter mile, half mile.
Nice two scout troops helped with this project, and there's still some signage that needs to be done. See if I can find that.
Yeah, there was one wet area that near the beginning of the trail on Kylie, near Kylie Drive, that a Boy Scout Eagle project did build about a 30-foot boardwalk to get across that wet area.
And the signpost that Will made for us put outside Chow Street Cemetery.
So do, forgive me for not knowing this, but do we fund any of this in the, for your materials or anything, or is that all done?
We get $1,000 a year from the town.
Get a whole $1,000.
Yeah.
Whether you need it or not, right?
Exactly. The rest we get from grants and big ball, we don't steal.
We've had two scouts, a Girl Scout and a Boy Scout, after their own fundraising had some funds left over, and they can't keep that or even pass it along to another scout, so they've both written checks to the committee, which goes right back into trails, and that's been really good. And sometimes when we have extra materials that are hard to find, we'll give that to a scout to get them going on a project too, so it goes both ways.
People do make donations. We have people in town who give out money. So we scrape by. If you want to give us more, we'll take it. Anyhow, so in the last year and a half or so, we've approximately done 226 hours of volunteer work out on the trails. Now, if you use the state standard of how much you can charge for unskilled volunteer labor, that comes out to $6,554. That was just for labor that doesn't include the materials we use in the trails. It's $29 an hour, the state figures you can charge for unskilled volunteer labor. We work closely with Walk Reading and Reading Open Land Trust. We have different walks in different areas. We have 2-3 walks a year. Different areas, different nature walks. We have bird walks. And the next event we have is coming up on June 4th and 5th. It's the Walk Ready weekend.
Yep. Just proclaimed it.
Just proclaimed it. So everybody knows about wearing red and getting out and walking on the 4th and 5th.
So do you have any sort of specific plans or marketing that you're going to let folks know about or organize efforts?
Oh, yes. Yes, we do. We have 6 events planned for that weekend. 3 on Saturday, 3 on Sunday. We have a nature walk. We have a historic homes walk. There's going to be geocaching. There's going to be...
Geo what?
Geocaching. I know, I'm old too. They take their GPS and they use it to find different sites around the town.
It's like you can like treasure hunt. There'll be a link on the town's homepage probably tomorrow. There's some information now under the Trails Committee.
So it's like orienteering.
Yeah. New style orienteering. Yeah.
Yeah, they will place, they have already placed a cache at the geographic center of Reading. And then the people that, the folks that go out and actually find it will get a little retreat from it.
I hope it's not in someone's living room.
Well, I think they put it in a convenient place. I believe it's on town land.
Let me just click through these and you can.
No.
Okay.
I'm doing some sort of random audit here. Oh, this is one of the walks. This is being read by Reading Open Land Trust. And it was, I do believe this is Walk Reading Weekend last year, which is now going to become, we're trying to make it an annual event. Last year we didn't do as well as the first year, so this year we're hoping to make up for it. So we need a lot of people to get out and walk Reading on the 4th and 5th of June. Thank you. You got somebody, Dan?
Yes.
Okay. This is the project we did in Cranberry, on the old Cranberry Dam.
It's in the town forest.
Town forest. You come out of Wood End School, you get down that trail.
Yep.
It's an old cranberry bog, and there was a dam there. And there was a bridge across, and the bridge was only 2.5 feet wide, and it was leaning to one side. Hmm. And when you got across the bridge, the path was even narrower than the bridge, and there was roots and a lot of tripping hazards. And you fell off 3 or 4 feet left and right, and you were going in the swamp. It was not user-friendly. So a scout came to us, Noah Hennings came to us and wanted an Eagle project. So he did building the bridge in Cranberry Dam. And he did a great job. And we thought, well, if he's going to build a bridge, maybe we can widen the path. So we went to conservation, got their permission to widen the path, build it up. And then it dawned on us that somehow we have to get the stone and the stone dust into the town forest. So we went to the DPW. And they were nice enough to truck 9 tons of crushed stone in for us. And we spent 2 weekends wheelbarrowing 9 tons of stone down a hill to 300 yards to the path. And we were done. It was 4 feet wide, nice and level. It was a great plan. We had to go get permission from conservation, had to work with the DPW, actually had to work with facilities so we knew how to get across that soccer field at Wood End School. And it just worked out great. It was the whole community. We had kids from college, we had kids from the high schools come and help us, we had the Boy Scouts showed up, anybody unfortunate enough to be walking by with a dog, we gave them a shovel, we went to work. And the path we built was 85 feet. It was 35 feet on one side, 50 feet on the other, and Noah's bridge was 12 feet or so, 4 feet wide. It turned out, so that you can actually get from the Wood End School to the middle of the town forest, no problem. Okay, this is Pineville. It's a nice conservation area on the south side of town, between Pineville and Washington Park, Martin Ave. And we went in there, and years ago, the scouts had gone in and built the boardwalk. And over time, of course, it started deteriorating. So we replaced the stringers underneath, replaced the boardwalk, and we cut at least a dozen trees falling down there. And there were some big trees, a foot, 2 feet in diameter. And we have a core of 10 to 12 people we can count on to help us with these projects. And this was several hundred feet of boardwalk we replaced out there. And we re-blazed the trail, and we rerouted the trail, because there was a couple of trails basically went nowhere out there. So we rerouted it. And we got the trail blaze, we got real lucky. Jean Jacobs got kids from her church to come out and blaze the trails for us. Mm-hmm. So we do get a lot of involvement from the town. Okay, we can move on to that. So, key lights. Yeah. Oh, this. The Ipswich River Association, they made us a deal. They would buy us that kiosk, but we should install it. So the town forest and the trails committee got together. Yeah, me and Terry were on the town forest. And we installed this, and it was a wet, cold day. And we figured, you're going to get it digged down 2 feet. How long is it going to take?
2-4.
This is the old gravel pit. The town forest used to be a gravel pit. We got down maybe half an inch before we hit gravel. So it took most of the day, but we put it up. And now the Ipswich River can use one side of that, and the town forest and the trails committee can use the other side. And it's located at the first outcropping going out in the Ipswich River, so anybody using the town forest pretty much has to go by this point. Mm-hmm. Okay, moving on. Okay. Another big mountain project.
That's a bird.
That's a bird one.
This is the next slide. The photo we'll show is of a little boardwalk that we put in right here. So.
Okay. That's one of the three bridges we built on Bear Meadow last year. That was in the summer. This is in the fall. Oh, moving forward. This is Sledge Woods. That's Ed and Bo. They're moving a tree. They're not practicing for the Scotland Highlander Games.
And a pasture road, memory.
Yes, and a pasture road. And we put that little boardwalk in, and this connects over to the Nichols woodlot. So yep. Now there's a continuous loop. We also had to go up, and the trail had disappeared out there. We had to go out and bushwhack a new trail and blaze it.
Blazing.
And this is blazing. I've been talking about blazing. Blazing is when we mark the trail, and that's Gene blazing the evergreen trail on the newest trail we have. As well, putting the signpost in. Oh, this is the parking lot at Matera Cabin, which is our base of operation. Anything we do pretty much comes out of this. This is one of the winter bird walks we do in January, between Christmas vacation and February vacation, when everybody's been in the house for too long. We try to get people out to go on the bird walk in the winter. So if you go for the bird walk, then we go back to the cabin where we have pastries and donuts and sweets and coffee and cocoa, and so it's a good deal. So you think about this come January.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
an
annual event. We do this every year.
And this,
along with Reading Open Land Trust and Walkable Reading, they're our co-sponsors.
Yeah. Conservation Administrator Chuck Tarone has been leading an effort to increase the parking there and get more use of the cabin. And this was just a great event. I think we had about 20 cars there and a lot more people than that. And this was after, actually, DPW was partway through the process of expanding the parking. It worked just really well.
Nice.
And that's it.
Used.
Yeah.
Pop up the platform, the viewing platform.
Just the only one, the one with replacing the.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. This is the viewing platform. This is in bare metal. It's a great platform. You should all go out and enjoy it. It also has a ramp that goes up to it. And there's a trail that goes from Matera Cabin to that platform. And it's ADA compliant. So we try to get everyone in the town a chance to get out and enjoy the outdoors. There's also two benches on the way out. And they were donated by Understanding Disabilities. And we hoodwinked the town into getting pouring two concrete slabs out there so we could put the benches down so people wouldn't borrow all the benches. Is that about it? Okay, now I got people to thank. I got to thank the DPW. DPW have been great to us. Whenever we ask them to do something for us, they do it. They augured the holes and put the sonotubes in for that platform. They hauled the stones out for us when we did the Cranberry Dam trail. They helped us raise the trail in bare metal 4 to 5 inches. They sent two guys out with a bobcat to help us do this. Great. They've been wonderful to us. Engineering helps us. The engineering goes out and surveys, tells us if we're going to have to get a hold of dig safe to get these projects done. Walk ready. We do lots of walk ready. Conservation, we always talk about conservation because we don't want to run afoul and do something stupid out there. The Boy Scouts, the Cub Scouts, the Girl Scouts. Which brings me to this pamphlet. This pamphlet was produced by Grace Strowman. She did a great job. Get this little pamphlet and to all the conservation areas, all the Reading Open Land Trust lands, the town forest. It also gives you the trails that are out there. She puts the activities you can do in these different areas. She tells you where you can park in these different areas. This is a great little book. And
where can you get that?
Ah, for $5, just a measly $5, we make, what do we make on this book? 7 cents? We make about 7 cents.
It goes into the general fund.
Yeah, we're losing money. We bought them for more than that.
The town clerk. That was a project for her gold award, I believe, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
She did a beautiful job.
She did.
Yeah,
she did an outstanding job in this. And I was thinking maybe you all can buy some of this and put them in the welcome wagon or something like that.
I don't think we have a lot left, to be honest with you. Last I looked.
All right, so everybody has to pony at $5 to get the book.
Maybe we can buy more, I don't know.
Town clerk's office or recreation, I think, has them too.
Okay. Good. Any questions?
No.
Board?
Nice job, you guys did a lot.
Nice job,
guys.
You
guys
got a lot
busy.
Done.
Really,
we need volunteers. We really need volunteers.
He's not leaving the room without volunteers.
They also could have used some.
Actually, there's some folks next door in North Reading. You might ask.
Beat the drum.
Thank you for your support.
Thanks, Kim.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tom.
Okay, I think that we're running a little behind here, so we've got a hearing that's got to get going.
Gary, you want to
tell us about the hearing?
No, this is a new one.
This is a new one.
Oh,
this
okay.
is a new one.
This cool. is for Bancroft?
Yeah.
Right. Page four.
Okay. Legal notice. To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen, the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on May 17, 2016 in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Wall Street, Reading, Mass. At 8:10 p.m. or thereabouts. Amend Article 5.2.2, Reading Resident Community Access, Sticker Residents Only Parking. Amend hours from 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. to 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. and restrict parking by permit on Hartshorn Ave on the northerly side between Hanscom Ave and Bancroft Ave from 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. from April 1st to August 31st. A copy of the proposed documents regarding these topics are available in the town manager's office or on the website. All interested parties invited to attend the hearing may submit their comments in writing by email prior to 6 p.m. on May 17th to town manager at ci.reading.nadus by order of Robert Walasher, town manager, May 10th, 2016.
Okay.
I'll start and then I'll invite the chief and others up. The board had a hearing recently on Bancroft Ave, and I'll just point here, it'll be a little easier.
Along the residential side, we've since put up signs, resident-only parking until 8 p.m. One of the neighbors had suggested that we extend that to 10 p.m., so that's one of the three actions that was suggested to the board a few weeks ago. Another action is to also limit the parking right along here, as was just read in the hearing notice on the northerly side of Hearnshorn. And the third one that was suggested and discussed a couple weeks ago that's not coming forward to you is to limit the parking to residential only on Hanscom. There's a hilly area, there's some question of visibility. The chief can explain the thought process that the BTTF went in, but basically if it's not safe, it's not safe for residents as well as non-residents. We shouldn't favor our non-residents over the residents. As is always the case, whenever the board changes any regulations, there's always sort of an aftermarket study of this, you know, unintended consequences or the follow-up. So anytime the board has changed something in the spring, we pretty much always sit down, at least internally by the fall, and think of things that happened that we didn't expect, or did everything work out just right. And, you know, we certainly intend to do that on Bancroft. The Birch Meadow Light project is out to bid now. We don't have results yet. You will have some data by the fall as to light usage and then parking. When it's time to sit down in the fall again and look at Hanscom, I suppose, and any other, you know, secondary effects that the neighbors or the police notice. So as was suggested, at least by me, a couple weeks ago, I don't think the town has any concerns whether it's 8 p.m. or 10 p.m. The suggestion at 8 p.m. was thought to be a benefit to the residents that live on that street to not limit the parking for their visitors. But, you know, if they don't object and want 10 p.m. instead, certainly the town has no objection to that. And then I thought it was a good suggestion made by one of the neighbors to do Hartshorn, where it had already had a limitation on the southerly portion, to just add the northerly portion. So again, those are the two suggestions coming through to you, is change the 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock on Bancroft, and then add that little short Hartshorn section, and also make that the same hours as revised Bancroft would be. So that's all I have.
Okay, would we hear anything else from the committee that came up with these findings?
I don't know, Chief, do you have anything to add to that?
No,
at this point?
That's pretty much where we're at with that. I would personally drove the hill on Hanscom to Bowl, but I grew up in, right over here on Hanscom Ave. And that hill, the idea of making it resident only, quite honestly, was either, I didn't want to open a can of worms, because quite honestly, if anyone's parked at the top of the hill, it is difficult to see down the hill. And we decided that, you know what, it'd just probably be better to be left alone, because it's almost that there should be no parking at the top of that hill, at the crest going down the hill, because it is concerning when you move out. But we're not going ahead with that right now. We just decided to be better off at this point to leave it as is. But like Bob pointed out, I have no issue at all with the resident only parking over there at 1 to 10 o'clock at night.
Okay. Public comment. Yes.
Is the parking on?
I'm going to ask Pat.
Oh,
identify
yourself. Mark Ventura.
Hi, Mark.
Belmont Street.
Yeah.
Reading Little League. I have three boys. Does that include the parking for the tennis courts and Morton Field in that area?
No.
That's all I have.
No. Other public comment?
Yeah.
Danny Kramer, Bancroft Ave. You put up signs, which was great, but they're not working. People are still parking there without their resident stickers or anything like that.
Have you
enforcement?
Okay. I have had officers down there tracking. I mean, if you see it happening, just call. You know.
Well, we Pat Moore, I live on Bancroft also. I mean, we're here all weekend long, and this Sunday there was absolutely no cars parked there that had a sticker at all. It's a big chore for the police department to be coming by every hour and a half to police, you know, the changes and the people coming and going. And it would be a lot easier if you just made no parking at all on Bancroft Ave and just solve the problem. And every car that's there is just, you know, a violation. It's very easy to spot. The other thing is that street also had no bus activities on the street. That sign's been taken down a couple of years ago, and we got school buses coming up and down the street, driving past the little playground on the corner. It's really a hazard. It shouldn't be a school bus backing up into a small cul-de-sac with little kids in the neighborhood.
Don't we have signs that now is it direct?
Yes.
If you just hang on a few minutes, John Feudo will discuss some of the signage in the area that's planned and upcoming.
All right.
But, I think that it really is important. I mean, the police can't position a cruiser there. You got to help them. I mean, well, this seems to be what the committee that the chief has been involved with, this seems to be the direction they'd like to go. But I know at the last time we talked about this, which was 2 weeks ago, you were urged as neighbors to make the call. It's my belief that if the call gets made and the enforcement gets made, then what's going to happen is people are going to realize they're being directed by kind of everybody that's using that area to please not park there, but to park either in the administration parking lot or in the parking lot next to the field house. I know that that's the direction that's coming from, from the school. Dan.
Why can't we just solve it by putting no parking there? So it's really a parking lot anyway. It's a dead end. There's only four houses there.
If I may. Danny, I spoke with you over the phone a couple times just for the board's review. So I think I spoke to the chief afterwards in regards to what we had discussed. And, at the end of the day, if something comes to that, I think that, that could be an option down the road. If you did that tomorrow, you're still going to have those people parked right there. So
you're still going to have to call the cruisers.
Biggest thing is, I think there has to be there's got to be a little bit of a learning curve that we're going to have to get people kind of associated with. So even if we did no parking whatsoever, or, I know we discussed maybe an extreme of saying, hey, do not enter unless you're a homeowner or going to the tennis courts, which would be, one of the big extremes, you're still going to have a little bit of a learning curve. So when I talked to the chief about it, the thought was, we got the signs up. Let's see how we can teach on that learning curve, and let's put it back to the parking task force to say, okay, if this isn't going to be the future plan, in other words, if this isn't going to really work out, what would be plan B from this point on? So I know he's going to discuss that with that task force to look into a little further. From the resident standpoint, it stinks a little bit because it's going to be a little bit of a time lapse as that goes on. So
I understand that.
Yep.
But I hear the rec committee and you guys talking about spending money diverting traffic. So if you're still going to put some resident parking, you're wasting time if you're diverting.
Yeah, and I can't speak for the subcommittee, but I think what they were trying to do was protect. And I know you live there. I mean, essentially what's gone on is nothing's changed from forever.
Yep.
It's always been what you're experiencing today is what you've been experiencing year after year. There's a sign up there now that people are ignoring. It was a no parking sign.
There wasn't signs before.
It was no, but you have a sign now.
You have a sign now.
That they're ignoring.
Yeah, for the most part, yeah.
So, it makes me wonder if you put a no parking sign, if they'd ignore that one too.
I think no parking means no parking. Resident parking means resident parking. So if you're a Reading resident, you can park there.
Yeah.
If you have a sticker.
How do we have that signage?
And half the city probably has a sticker.
Yeah.
Well, how is that signage board?
I raise that point.
Not good. I mean, first of all, they're directed in the wrong way, I think. They think they can be directed in a different way. But I think at the end of the day, that would probably be the best solution to just put no parking at all. We all have a driveway down there. We can all use our own driveway.
And it makes it really easy for the police department. They don't have to, cars are parked the wrong way. They're facing the wrong way in the car. Now the police officer has to get out of the car, walk around. The sticker's on the other side of the car. I mean, it just makes it hard for the police department to even enforce it. Yeah. So, and every other street over there in that entire neighborhood, there's no parking on the street except for where it's most congested. That doesn't make sense.
Now, how many other homes? You're another homeowner down there?
Yeah.
Now, there's two more, right? So there's four houses
total?
There's
four houses there.
Right.
Okay.
And I can't even get out in and out of my driveway sometimes. I mean, people park and half my driveway's blocked. It's incredible.
I'll make it clear, if they're blocking the driveway whatsoever, we will tow, okay? That I don't have a problem with, we just can't tow. It's only, the bylaw only allows us a $20 fine for the parking violation, but I mean, if they're blocking a driveway, leaving a car in the middle of the road, something like that, we can gladly, but I will make sure they tow it out.
I mean, so bad they double park behind the tennis court people. People are parked legitimately in spaces, and people park behind them because they go into the game, and it's unbelievable down there. And then a school bus comes. It's incredible. Compared to what it was 5 years ago, it's unbelievable.
Yeah?
Yep. Two questions for the chief. One, if you see a car parked on the wrong side of the street, why don't you just ticket them? Do you?
If they're parked on the wrong side of the road?
Yeah, if they're facing the wrong way, that's a violation.
Yeah, absolutely, we can ticket them.
Okay.
Yeah,
secondly, are you issuing warnings, you know, like you
so
do?
So we did through last weekend, through last week, and we did warnings.
So you could do a blanket pass through there, and if you see anybody without a
we
sticker.
We did warnings through last weekend because I wanted to give people a little bit of water grip, you know, before.
Put things on the windshield,
it's an orange warning sticker.
Yeah,
it looks
like
a regular ticket,
with the snow hours,
it's a warning.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
It explains what they did wrong on there.
Right. Also, we were also going to contact Google and get the coordinates kind of vectored over to the high school parking lot when you.
It's my understanding that has been done.
Right?
Isn't that true?
That should be helping.
It's been done.
Okay. We verified.
I think it's been done.
It was
I think
done
it was actually done
a few months ago.
A few months ago. I mean, so the thing that is a little baffling is, I mean, the school bus thing is.
Yes.
I know that there's been clear direction in the Middlesex League about buses there. They've been told not to go there. I know that to be true.
Mm-hmm. Can I make a quick comment? There was a bus down there on Sunday. I was with the athletic director yesterday, and he said he sent an email Friday afternoon, said, please don't have buses go down there. So we're doing what we can on our end. Our athletic director is extremely conscientious of what's going on. He understands the issue. But we're trying to coordinate that with other athletic departments and other bus companies. It's just, it's an uphill battle. So to address that issue about the sign that's not there, we're working to try to get that no bus sign back up past this point. I think that would help, but we're
is
doing
that part of the proposal tonight that you're going to
it's not actually in that part. This is more of a wayfinding proposal, but that is absolutely in the plan to put that sign back up.
Yes.
Dave Sweeter, 98 Hartron Street. So I know we have three residents of the four houses on Bancroft Street.
Yep.
Why don't we take a simple vote of what their recommendations are?
Well, okay. First of all, I'll get to you in a minute, Bob, but that really is not the way that it's done, David.
Okay.
And I think
so
you know
that.
I mean, it's very important to hear from, and I recognize all of these people. I've been to their homes, as you well know. I've spent a lot of time and energy down in that, and I feel very strongly that you guys, I've always tried to advocate on your behalf. I'm not sure that is not the way that we can get it done.
John, what is the message you've heard from the neighbors then? They're here. Please tell
them. Well, the message I've heard is that they're looking for no parking rather than, and I haven't heard from the last neighbor that's there, but I'm guessing he's here in support of that. Bob, you had something?
just my point is there's a legal process the town must follow. The town must post a hearing saying no parking if that's what it wishes, and we didn't do that because that was not a recommendation previously. That can happen in the future.
For the point, there's three of them here. It's a consistent message. They're all asking for no parking on that area. I think you have to respect that.
Yeah, respect it.
So
it's certainly being heard, David.
Right.
There's no question.
That's fine. I just make sure that everybody knows there's three of them here. So I've suggested some additional parking signs that go down there. One is for the access where the chain gate is, to have a no parking sign put on that.
Okay. Yep.
The other one would be at the rock at just before you come to the tennis court parking, because it would make it clear that that is a no parking zone. And I've suggested a stop sign on Bancroft heading north, and that apparently didn't come through.
The stop sign came through, but the problem was it's not an intersection. The stop, there's nothing in through the state's rules that would allow us really to put a stop sign there heading that direction. You're talking in front of
You know exactly what I'm saying. It's a problem. I've seen them hit there. You've seen them hit there.
I know exactly what you're talking about. I can do this. I can go back to the parking traffic task force in 2 more weeks, and we can bring up the no park. I'm sorry, I missed the last meeting you guys had. I was away that week, but I gladly could bring that up if you'd like for the no parking. But I'd like to bring it up to the board to go about it the right way.
Right.
To the task force, I mean. And also the additional signs that where I know what he's talking about should not be an issue. I would just have to talk to the task, put it in front of the task force as well for the no parking signs, because one thing he is talking about is the path that should no one should be parking in front of the block.
Yeah, in front of the chain.
Right. Yeah.
Because
absolutely.
That's your way in and out.
Correct.
If you have an emergency vehicle or anything else.
Absolutely. So that is very reasonable.
So I pulled down this weekend just to see who was and who was not legally parked at that location. The problem I had was the only way I could turn around was to use one of my neighbor's driveways. So that means that I have to back up. And if I have to back up, others have to back up. I'm sure I drive better than they do.
Well, it's your neighborhood. You're paying attention. Yeah.
And it's difficult. It's just a safety issue. It really, really is a safety issue that the neighbors are trying to solve.
He's absolutely right. Anybody trying to back out of that tennis court almost hits every car on the other side of the street. Since I've been living there, my car's been backed into twice.
So, thank you
for
your time.
Yep. Any other public comment regarding this topic? Anything else from the board?
So as I understand it, there's no objection to what's before the board tonight. The residents-only parking hour change on Hartshorn and Bancroft.
Well, so
that's not being disputed, but there are other issues you want revisited.
Well, it sounds like that's not being disputed, but it also sounds like the neighbors are looking for more attention. Sounds like the chief is ready to, you know, reconvene and discuss that. And I think in fairness to that committee, what they were hoping to do for those three of you that are on Bancroft, I think the goal was to create some protections for you and not limit your own rights. It sounds like you give up your own rights,
with the rights.
In favor of having no parking on the street there.
If we could get it the other way, that would be great. That doesn't really seem to be path right now.
Yes, Chief.
I'm sorry, did you say what the other way?
If we could park, have just those four houses, be able to, if they have a company, put a...
Right, again, your own park. See, I think the problem with that was setting
that's
the problem.
That's why we went to the full way.
And I think our goal was
I think that was the point of the resident-only parking, so that you could back out in front of your own house. And
we thought that was true, but then I find out anyone who has a sticker for the...
I predicted that.
Right. And I think he's right that we were looking to kind of help you all so you could still park in your own house without having to have no parking. No parking will be no parking for everybody,
If that's what it takes.
We're trying to make it work the best. Right, all right. That's what we were trying to do, is to make it kind of
reasonable.
I
get it.
It's not the parking, though. Sometimes it's the speed people drive down there. They drive 30 miles an hour into a dead-end street, and then back up 20 miles an hour because they think a reserved spot is next to the field for them. And that's really not happening.
Actually, I have seen that movie.
Yeah. And you got to remember, there's a playground right there.
Absolutely.
Little kids walking in the streets. I mean, we've got 3- and 4-year-olds in the neighborhood, and one of those kids is going to get hit one of these days.
So why don't I, if it's okay with the board, I'll go and reconvene with the parking task force.
I guess procedurally, I mean, should we... It seems like we could proceed here.
Yeah.
There's not a challenge to anything that's in tonight's hearing or being proposed.
Right.
It sounds like, we need to revisit it and look at more. And so I think we act on this and,
I think it makes sense. This is all new. So I think it makes sense to, especially since there's no objection, approve what's in front of us now. Ask the chief, with the help of the neighbors, to rigorously enforce that, and let's see what happens.
Give it a chance to work.
Give it a chance. I mean, if people are starting to get parking tickets there, the word will get out, and they won't park there. If that's not the case, then maybe we do need to look at making it no parking. Although, you know, then I ask you, the question I had is, where are your guests going to park?
It's going to be hard to unregulate that bill, so, I guess, is what I'm saying, once it's there.
So, I mean, I'd like to kind of see how this works, especially, you know, another season goes by, and now all the athletic directors know you're not putting your buses down there. You're putting them where the administrative buildings are. And sometimes when you do these changes, it takes a while, and I understand it's frustrating for the neighbors. But, we'd like to just kind of let's see how what we enact works. And if it doesn't work, let's revisit it.
I would urge you to make those calls that were encouraged, 2 weeks ago. People don't like to pick up the phone and call the police, but, it's a situation that we're trying to, I don't think it's going to take months of enforcement. I think that, some weeks of enforcement is either going to say it's going to work, or it's going to become a great revenue source for the town. One of the two, I don't know which, but you see what I'm saying? Because once you get what you're asking for, you need to be sure that's what you really want, I guess, is all I'm, that's the only caution I give to you. So, any other comment on the matters of the hearing?
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on Hartshorne and Bancroft Ave parking regulations.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Okay.
Move that the Board of Selectmen amend the Town of Reading Traffic and Parking Regulation Article 5.2.2, Reading Resident Community Access Sticker, Residents Only Parking, by amending the hours from 2 p.m. to 8 p.m. to 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. Move that in accordance with Article 5.2.2, parking shall be restricted by permit to those with a Reading Resident Community Access Permit sticker from the hours of 2 p.m. to 10 p.m. from April 1st to August 31st. Street to be amended, Hartshorne Street, location on street, northerly side between Hanscom and Bancroft, Regulation 12, pursuant to Article 5.2.2.
Regulation Article 12.
Yep. Any discussion? Further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 4-0. Okay, so
thank you.
Chief, you're gonna look at this thing a little more deeply with me.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Get the parking tickets ready.
That'd be a good time for a recess.
What's up next?
Wait a minute, you're gonna do the Morton Field.
Let's do that. Let's
maybe hear from Morton.
I'm assuming that's gonna be quick.
Yep.
Morton Field signs. Although they're not really Morton Field signs, they're
no, way, they're Morton Field. Signings. Yeah, the Birch Meadow Complex area signs. Right here, yes. So just to jump back really quickly on that comment about the bus signage, I will make that as long as it's okay with the PD. I think Mark might have left, but as long as it's okay with the PD, I would make that a personal goal to go and get that sign put back for the buses, the no buses at this point. I'm not sure why that came down at some point.
I can't imagine why that would come down.
Yeah. It disappeared maybe, I can't even tell you.
Somebody took it home?
Nobody noticed that it was missing.
Let's make sure it's bright.
So, yeah, no, I think it was. It was fine at the time. So, John Feudal, Community Services Director for the town, for those that don't know me. I ventured out a couple weeks ago to start looking at the other end of this issue, is trying to divert some of the traffic out of that neighborhood. Addressing the parking is one thing, but addressing the actual traffic going down that side of Bancroft is another part of it. So I developed this this wayfinding program that I hope that you'll review and accept. It's basically another way to ensure that the neighbors' concerns have been addressed and part of the town's commitment to listen to our friends down on Bancroft Ave and the surrounding streets. So when I set out, you guys have probably seen this slide before, it's basically a sample of some of the wayfinding that are in other communities. I think you're going to see this pop up in the Birch Meadow Master Plan. When we finalize that plan, I think you're going to see a recommendation for lots of signage down there directing people in many different ways, whether it's bathrooms, whether it's other parts of the complex. So there's some really neat structures that are out there. The town of Winchester's got a great program. So at some point, we'll review that with you. But for tonight and for our purposes, I want to talk a little bit about the specifications and recommendations that we're making to the Board of Selectmen. So So we've already got a sample sign in town that we could work off of, and many of you have seen it. There's one down on Lowell Street, there's a couple on Main Street, it's the Reading Center sign. It's attractive, it stands out, and it's different than the other signs that we have. It's not a metal sign, it's a PVC coated sign, it looks sharp. If you walk up to it, it's quite dense. It's about 18 by 24 inches in size. And our mounting system for these signs would be on telephone poles, and we have to actually put one post in. These signs, it's important for you to know, have been reviewed by our planning staff as well as our police department. So they're good with what we're proposing, and they understand what we're trying, what the goal is of the program. They also would go uniform and standard with the traffic control device manual program that's throughout the state and actually throughout the country. I'm proposing 9 signs total. I could have put 50 after driving around the neighborhoods. There's many places you could do it, but we tried to whittle it down. The other thing that's important to know is, as Bob mentioned, we've changed the coordinates on Google, but we've also, anywhere we could find it, we've had the coordinates changed for Morton Park to 62 Oakland Road. So we're trying to really get all GPSs to work there. Those that have been to Morton before know that it's on Bancroft Avenue. We'll still search that and use their GPS. So I thought what would be the best way to do this is to GPS it myself. So I used my own GPS to actually come up with this wayfinding to try to figure out the best way to go about it. So here's the map. I'm actually going to put a paper copy up here as well, because I'm going to have to probably jump back and forth. The one thing I noticed right away was there's 2 major hubs that Google will send you based on what highway you're coming from. So if you're coming from out of town, you're either coming from Interville Terrace off of 93, or you're coming down Bancroft Ave off of 95 or Route 1, whichever the case may be. So it actually makes it quite simple as far as the solution is. You put wayfinding signs at the beginning or ends of both of those routes. So you can see there's actually 8 depicted, but there's actually going to be 2 signs at this corner here. I think that's Longfellow Road. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you on a quick virtual tour. I did some photoshopping just to give you a quick heads up. The photos are not to scale, so there's some signage on here. So if you come to Reading via 95 or Route 129, and you've GPSed anywhere down Bancroft Ave, you're going to run into Bancroft at Weston Road. That's the first opportunity to move traffic the other direction. So you hit Weston, you would see the sign, and then you would move on to, this is Longfellow Road. Mm-hmm. And you move on to Longfellow, you'd go Weston to Longfellow, and then you'd wind up Longfellow to Oakland. Yes. I think there's somebody's house in the back.
They're going to park on my lawn.
So we're diverting traffic back around to the high school, and eventually we're finding ourselves to the Fieldhouse parking lot, which seems to make sense. This is the only post that we'd have to add. The rest of these signs can all go on telephone poles, which is a great option. They'd go high enough off the ground so nobody could vandalize or take them down. The next place we would start is coming from the other direction. We'd be at Interville Terrace, and this is actually even easier because you get off 93, you come down 129, take your left-hand turn at P&S, you wind up at the stop sign where it says ballpark parking, you follow along all the way to Birch Meadow Drive, and you wind up back to the entrance to the field house. So those are 2 very easy solutions. The third is we're trying to prevent people from going down. This is previously where the bus-only sign was, and we can actually put that even further up. But this would divert people from going actually down to the field. So it's a last-ditch effort to try to get people to turn. If they see this sign...
That in the wrong direction, though?
Nope, because they would come to this point, and then they would go bankrupt to Hartshorne.
Yeah, got it.
And then this is where it gets a little tricky. We'd actually have to put signs on both sides of this pole. But it would be Hartshorne to John Carver and Hartshorne to John Carver. And we're basically turning people possibly in 2 separate directions. But they would all wind up back along Birch Meadow Drive back to the field house. So that's really our goal as we were looking at this. We tried not to overdo it with the signs. The signs may not be quite as bright as that. I think they'd be closer to match the color of the actual street sign. But we did the black on the red background with the orange arrow to really make it stand out so people would see it. People will be following their GPSs. I don't know how closely people will follow the signage, but our hope is that people will not go down to the end of Bancroft. And what we're trying to do is recreate a habit here and get people in the habit of following the signage around to the parking lot at the high school. One of my recreation committee members was actually down at the baseball game yesterday with the tennis match going on, and he realized that when he was parked if he were to park on Hartshorn or park in the field house, he was actually closer.
Once they discover,
yes,
parking at the field house or for the Little League games, absolutely parking correct at the administrative parking lot, all you got to do is park there once.
So simple.
And you know it's so simple and closer. Yeah.
And the access is better to get in and out. The access is far better. If you're parked at the end of Bancroft Ave and the baseball game lets out, it could be a few minutes you can actually get down, back up Bancroft Ave. So ease of parking.
So how many signs altogether?
90. It's 9 signs altogether.
Would you mind putting the map up?
Sure.
Can I just make a suggestion to you?
Absolutely.
So if you're coming down, you're on Lowell Road, 129.
Lowell. So Lowell is actually not depicted on here. It's not quite down.
Yeah, it's right there.
Oh, I'm sorry. So then you can turn yep.
So.
Do you want to put one here, John?
Yeah. What happens is many people take different routes off of Lowell Street to get down to that ballpark. And in my opinion, for the small amount of money that we're talking about, more signs are better. And I would think about, just go sit down there on baseball game day one time, and you'll see how they sneak in. And it's the GPS is taking you a certain way, and I think that's the way you laid the signs out. And I think that is a great first step. Mm-hmm. But I would suggest to you that more will be
more better. Is okay.
Would you suggest a back-to-back sign there in case they're coming this way on Lowell or that way?
I think because they will come both ways.
Yes, sir.
I mean, I've had people for unquestionably come down to that ballpark from the Rotary in Wakefield.
Yep.
You know, they get on 129, and then they come across Lowell, and they'll pick one of the streets. Maybe it's Bancroft to make the right, and they head. So the more of those opportunities you give them to circle around, you know, either the front or the back of the school, either one, I think is...
It makes sense.
Yeah.
Can you put a sign, tons of signs all the time in front of the deli? So,
like an A-frame sign?
Yeah, it just says, you know, so basically you want to go down Intervale, right? And then from Intervale to go, instead of left, you go right. So, I mean, everybody notices signs at the deli. So if you can just put it like in that...
There might be a pole. I didn't investigate a pole opportunity. There might be a telephone pole there that we might be able to take advantage of. We're trying to avoid, you know, populating the streets with a bunch of posts and a bunch of signs. Just because
I think you'll find that there's a lot of telephone poles available to utilize.
No, I think so.
I agree. You know, if you put a million poles,
I just don't want to.
Then you have a million poles in.
Right.
But I think that there's probably ample opportunity to add more signage. I mean, I would be in favor of what you're doing and urge you to, and would, you know, from my perspective, encourage more signage in all the likely places that, because the problem that was described by the neighbors earlier, this is not new. I mean, that problem has been there a long time, and it's real. I mean, it's definitely real. So
I'm glad to add a sign to that. If you would like, we could leave it somewhat open-ended to allow myself to work with the police department to take it. I tried to limit the amount of signs because I thought that was the better route, but if you're comfortable with more signage, glad to collaborate with the PD on that.
I just noticed one that if for folks coming in from the north down Main Street, down Forest, you might want to put one at the end of Arthur B. Lord Drive where it meets Birch Meadow, directing them to turn left instead of right. I think that's an important place.
Any other comments from the board?
No, so too, the more signs people see, whether they're, you know, even if they're not going to a game or just in their daily routes and travels, it's going to start getting into people's minds that there's a way to go to Parker to Ballpark.
Yeah.
It's just sort of, it's like dripping on folks.
John, are you talking about putting a sign out on Lowell Street, guiding them down one of those three?
Absolutely. Interviews? I would.
You know, the only thing I'd worry about that is you're really picking a street that already... Those three streets already get a good amount of traffic. Uh-huh. Now you're diverting it to just one of them, rather than having it, you know, spread out over three. I think you're better off to put it deeper in, not on Lowell Street, so they can pick which one of those three. You know, they're going to go down.
The idea of putting
diverting them that way.
The GPS is going to take them on in front of PNS and onto Intervale. Right. That's where the GPS is.
Right.
takes them now.
And Google Maps sends you there.
Okay. So I guess what I was really talking about was I'd be fine with a sign there because they're likely being directed there anyway. So it's like, oh, okay, I'm on it now. I'm talking about when you get deeper in, when you get deeper in off of Lowell Street.
Yeah.
Because people don't always just use Intervale. They,
right,
you
there's,
know.
There's Hartshorne,
I think,
one they could use.
If I could just make a quick comment. When I looked at this from people coming from out of town that may not know where they're going.
Yeah.
My expectation is that the people in town will get in the habit of moving over to the other parking lots via our organizations just being really good about letting them know and steering them. Our residents know every which way around that corner versus out of town people are just kind of wayfinding their way with a GPS or with any kind of, you know, list they found on the internet.
Well, my thought is not to limit you to the amount of signs that you're proposing tonight and to work with the chief's office and just use good judgment.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, to me, I think we all have the same goal. Is that right? We want to get the traffic moving to a parking lot,
right?
Not to somebody's front yard.
Right.
I mean, that's kind of the goal here.
Right. So. And there will be some people that ignore our signs and just listen to their GPS and say, "All right, I said this location, and I'm just going to go to the location."
Eventually, they'll drive off a cliff, though.
Well, eventually, they'll understand when they get down there. Gee, maybe this is why they were pointing us in this direction.
To get that one first parking ticket,
right,
in front of somebody's house.
Right.
What else you got?
That was it on this front. If there's any other,
I'm
glad to take any other comment.
No, I don't think we do.
I think we're good.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm armed and dangerous. I'll go out and wrap this part of it up. Bob had actually asked me to mention two other projects that are coming on the forefront from a couple of our youth organizations. I'll start with Morton Field itself. There's a pretty good movement from Reading Babe Ruth to erect a dedication sign to Newt Morton and Pete Moscarello. Many of you remember back in the fall, the field was renamed Peter Moscarello Ballpark at Newt Morton Field. That group is ready to go, and they're just wondering what the next steps would be. And we'd hope to get them in front of you sooner than later. They'd like to get that dedication done over the next few months, if possible. So I wanted to just mention that tonight. And I'm actually flanked here by some of the gentlemen from Reading Little League, Mark Ventura, who spoke earlier, Andy Fotino, and Steve Zassis, who's the sitting president of the organization. And they've also come to me with a augmentation to something that was previously permitted, was a manual scoreboard down at the tennis court baseball field. After doing some research, they decided that they'd be better spent getting a solar scoreboard put in. That seemed to make sense to them. So not having to worry about electronics, but actually putting something that was energy efficient, low cost, and hopefully low maintenance.
Climate Committee was here early. You could have had that presentation.
They'd have been dancing.
That would
have
been perfect. So they're anxious.
The lights up there won't work for the night games.
It won't work for the night. It's true. Hopefully it has some
kind
of storage.
Oh, you have the battery backup storage power.
Yeah, the battery backup storage power. So they're very anxious to get that in for their summer season as well. And so we're hoping, Bob had mentioned that perhaps over the next few weeks.
So has that gone through staff?
Staff has reviewed
the reports we need so we can act on this thing.
Yep.
No time is of the essence.
Yes, staff has reviewed the project. Building inspector has weighed in and said they need to pull building permit for it. They've reviewed it with engineering, and they've actually gone as far as pulling as-built for the area.
Okay.
So they're well managed and well ready, and very much ready to go.
On the outfield, or
They're looking at about right center field. The
right center
field there, right?
And you just opened up, right? Season.
They've been open for a while, right?
We've been open. STS. Mark Ventura, director of field, 142 Belmont Street, Reading.
I saw him down there. They did a nice job.
Yeah. STS came out. That's a company we hire every year to redo the skins.
Okay.
Just with the rainy season, they were delayed a little bit. So they sort of mid-season. I think it was even later than last year with all the snow we had.
Oh,
they finally made it out.
Okay.
So do we need a hearing for this, Bob?
No, it'd just be similar discussion.
So, probably at the next
meeting.
So somebody will come, and you'll have everything you need to.
Yeah, we'll be done making the
move. Time for the next meeting, Bob. We can put that in.
As long as I get stuff from the engineers and building inspector or whoever else.
Okay.
Yeah,
I've been in touch with George and the new
Ryan.
Gentleman coming in.
Ryan.
Coming in. I did get the as-built to the plan.
Okay.
I did get the lighting plan. It looks like we're clear of everything. So we have been working at it.
Okay.
We'll just need a permit for the footings. And there will be a sign company installing it. It's not going to be, you know, Andy and I out there with some post hole diggers. You know, there's footing designs and everything else that are going into this.
Just for historical perspective, before that fence was built, the coaches, before game time, would put the movable fences in and trying to find where we had dug. Yeah, and we actually dug the holes. So it was great for the first month, and then when the grass grew, you could never find the holes.
Yeah, so. No, it's difficult. And we have that problem at Eaton, but it's a thing.
Now you guys can actually concentrate on coaching.
Yeah.
For those of us
coaches that
were
older, I played
on that
field in the late 70s.
The ball would just disappear over the side of the
lower before the tennis courts were built.
Okay.
Great.
We'll get you back on the – get all that together so that we can get back on our agenda.
Yeah, have you seen our proposal?
I have not.
Not yet.
We have not seen it.
Okay, we have copies here we can distribute.
Well, so what will happen is it'll find its way right back to our email box.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay? You know, John knows the drill. And then we'll have everything. If you get everything you need, then we get everything we need. And then 2 weeks goes – are we up in 2 weeks? When are we on?
I'm not sure. It's two,
no,
or,
it's
two or three.
That would be Memorial.
The 7th is the next.
Yeah, the 7th. That sounds right.
Yeah.
Sounds like the 7th.
We did email it in April at some point, but we'll send it again.
Well,
yeah, no,
just
we'd
so
be happy to. It probably
just so you're aware, okay?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, no, understood.
Nobody wants to stand in your way, but no one up here has seen it.
No, I understand.
Okay, so,
I understand. I didn't mean to be, that wasn't my intent.
Okay.
It sounds
good.
Like,
we're on the same page here.
Yes, excellent. Thank
okay.
you. We're excited.
Good. And the have the guys from Babe Ruth figured out where and size and all that kind of stuff for in a similar way so that
yes, those specifications are all set up and Jeff is ready to go.
Okay. So that'll clear staff and then we'll see that too.
Yep.
Okay.
Sure.
Good.
Play ball.
Take a 2 minute recess and I'll fetch our
okay.
Yep.
Visitors.
Yep.
Thank
okay.
you very
thanks,
much.
Guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Crack a window behind you, Joe.
One tonight, boy. I'll tell you, a lot going on here. And we're here welcoming our friends from North Reading, who we've been talking to for quite some time, actually, over the idea of a collaborative effort to help them and, you know, probably
satisfy some needs for ourselves as well with the MWRA. And so I guess, Bob, you're going to have a little presentation to kind of cue this thing up,
and here we go. And this is a lot different from their overview, because this is how Reading sees it. So hopefully there'll be some things in common. First, I'd like to introduce four members of the board who are here. Chair Robert Masseri, Vice Chair Steve O'Leary, Jeff Yull, and Catherine Manupoli, if I said that close. And Mike Briscoe could not be here tonight. In the back, in the next row, Town Administrator Mike Gilberto and Water Superintendent Mark Clark are also here.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Reading's opinion of North Reading's current situation, which is interesting. They have a different starting point than we did, and I'm going to compare how Reading used to look just for the local flavor. Currently, North Reading gets about 60% of its water supply from Andover through an intermunicipal agreement, and about 40% from the Ipswich River. One of the first problems is that's probably not sufficient right now for North Reading, but it certainly is not going to be sufficient for North Reading. They have a lot more open land to develop than we do, and they have some economic development objectives, and they don't have the water supply that's necessary to fuel that economic development, so that's certainly a problem. And the next problem, which has become, I guess, more clear in the last few years, is that in order to continue to draw from the Ipswich River, they need more capital investments, just as we did some time ago. If you go back about 10 years, Reading was drawing 100% from the Ipswich River. We had a water treatment plant. We did not have sufficient capacity for a peak summertime demand at that point. We were running into those issues at that point. So we did a partial buy into the MWRA for about $3 million just to tide us through the 3 or 4 months of the summer for peak usage, and that we didn't use them for the winter. We did that for a couple years, and then we ran into a similar problem as you are. We needed capital investments to continue to use the Ipswich River. We needed to build a whole new water treatment plant. So we did a lot of financial analysis, as you folks have done. I think our capital costs might have been a little higher because it was a larger plant compared to the wells you have. So we had a very interesting town meeting, a one-night session. The doors were locked, no one was allowed to leave. It was very, very good discussion. I clearly remember it. I'm going to guess that the vote was about 55% to 45%, maybe even closer.
Yeah, about that. Yeah.
And one of the gentlemen on the losing side stood up and made a motion to reconsider for the unification of the town, and it was almost unanimous that they went to the majority. That's the kind of spirit that was in the room that night. It was really interesting. And it was a very complex discussion. There were issues like control, local control, that you folks ran into last week. So that's sort of the Reading background and color. And our results are very good. Our water quality is phenomenally better than it was. Some of the plumbers in town aren't happy about that, but everyone else is. When we did our financial analysis, we used 6 to 10% bands for the annual increase by the NWRA, which was about their forecast at the time, believe it or not. Their actual increases have been more like 4 to 5%, which is in over a 10-year period is a huge reduction in what costs we expected, which is good. And we still are paying debt service off on that buy-in, where we did it in two phases especially. So for North Reading, they have come to the conclusion they really need to join the MWRA and do a full buy-in, which is about $8 million for them. As was shown at a public meeting in North Reading last week, the two options, one is to tie in through Wilmington and one is to tie in to Reading, and they prefer the Reading option. The Wilmington option may serve them in the short run, and perhaps some sewer, but they really believe that through Reading is a much stronger connection. This is a quick snapshot of their time frame. They have a town meeting, I believe it's in the first week of June, to get some design funds. Their construction will be almost 2 years, and their key date in that red star there is middle of 2019. Their objective is to have joined the MWRA and drawing water from the MWRA at that point. And they'll decommission their facilities after that. So what's in it for us? Are we just good neighbors? Well, that's partly true. But as all of us, we have a fiduciary responsibility to protect our taxpayers and our water ratepayers too. So we're in it to be nice, but for other reasons. First of all, it should be said out loud that, you know, there's 350 odd communities, some of them very odd, in the Commonwealth. And that's no way to set up local government. It's tremendously inefficient. So we use a lot of mutual aid, because as was discussed earlier with the chief, you know, you just can't do everything that your community needs. You have to share with others, and we do that both with staff, and we do a lot more mutual aid that's unofficial and just being good neighbors. If Reading helps the MWRA get more customers and sells more water, in theory that lowers rates for everyone, just like if we would sell more water in Reading. As the water commissioners, you know that story. There'll be a relatively modest wheeling charge that will cover Reading's extra water system wear and tear that we will tack on in some way. As I understand it, the current entry into the NWRA has a 25-year zero interest loan available, which we did not have when we joined.
Which we should have.
So Fred's going to be paying big time on this one.
Can we refinance that?
Well, I have talked to all of the legislatures, including one last week who wasn't even mine, but it was yours, and just basically said, whatever North Reading gets, Reading is interesting in sharing. Whatever advantage that is offered to them, that's fine. They should get the best deal they can. We'd like some part of that deal. So, you know, we don't have any formal proposals. We have three or four options to discuss with the MWRA, and we have for years. But the long and short of it is we're still paying another $1.5 million of just interest payments right. on our buy-in. We've already paid $4 million of interest on our buy-in. You don't have to pay that, I hope. For our system, this will be a little bit better from an engineering standpoint. We'll have more stable pressure and flows, and there'll be less nitrification because we'll be in the middle of a system and not at the end of a system. And I think this last one, hopefully it never matters, but I think it's maybe one of the more important ones. We will gain redundancy through Andover, through North Reading, through Andover. When and if they're allowed to join the MWRA, assume they will, I'm sure they will want to keep and probably be mandated to keep an emergency access through Andover. Much as we have been mandated to keep emergency access to the Ipswich River right now. So we can't produce drinkable water from the Ipswich River, but if we had a fire and we had low water flows and the MWRA had some kind of interruption, as happened many years ago, we can draw as much water as we need to fight fires from the Ipswich River, and then we'd have to purify our system afterwards.
Is that hydrologically possible? I thought the pumps yes. go from south to north.
It is hydrologically possible, and as I learned last week, one direction flows a lot easier. Whether you got to pump it up north and
that was mentioned,
flows
yeah.
back
yeah.
south,
yeah.
I think.
Okay.
So yeah, and that's a good point, Dan. Our DPW staffs, our engineering staffs, and some technical folks, consultants, have spent a year discussing this. It was just like a Dr. Seuss book. Two people were coming at a problem from each side, and you hope they met in the middle. They didn't at first, not for a while. But eventually the consultants and staff all agreed that this is possible, and they came up with a solution that would allow the two systems to, if you will, you know, exchange water with each other.
Okay.
So one of Reading's long-term goals has always been to have a backup. What's coming through from Stoneham on Main Street is a second MWRA connection, which is good.
Right.
This is better. You know, then we'll have, if the MWRA has a colossal problem down
yeah.
south, we'll have another solution and drinkable water from Andover. We also have some future capital costs if we, you know, are required to keep the Ipswich River connection. We'll have some capital costs to do that, and we'd like to avoid that. We'd like to just abandon it entirely, although keep our rights. What's not in it for us, and this was also something discussed over the last year, we'll have some limited role in overseeing construction, much as we would for any project in town, such as when the state comes in and paves a road. But North Reading will pay for all of it. The Reading Board of Selectmen will have to give permission for work to be done in Reading, which is relatively simple. We will not issue any debt. North Reading will not have to repay us. We will not need any Reading town meeting actions. The selectmen, sometime I'm sure this summer, will be asked to approve either an intermunicipal agreement with two phases or maybe two different agreements, one to cover design, if you will, and then another to cover ongoing operations 3 years hence or so. And lastly, in the future, we've had limited discussions. It's a long time to get there, but we're certainly willing to discuss any arrangement that we find mutually beneficial if North Reading's interested. You know, we could form a water district. There's not many of them in the state, but there's a few. So
what's the benefit of a water district?
one set of workers in one location, probably. Yeah. You know, it's hard to say. There's different ways you could set it up. Mm-hmm. But we just, you know, had enough discussion to say, yeah, anything's on the table down the road. You know, let's get there. And the same is roughly true with most of our neighbors. Woburn, not so much because they have a different form of government, I think. But we have all kinds of interesting discussions with all of our border towns on arrangements. Some of it's emergency-based, but some of it is, what if in the future we did this? So that, you know, we've had that kind of a simple discussion with North Reading. So there has been about a year. Selectmen Halsey and Ensminger from our side have been at quite a lot of meetings. Our DPW staff, Jeff and Ryan, are in the back, have had quite a lot of meetings. Reading wants this to happen almost as much as North Reading does, because it does benefit us. There's clear benefits to Reading as well. You know, we really appreciate the spirit of communication and cooperation that Mike's had.
If I may mention, we have a cap on the amount of water we can draw from through our ground wells, and it's just slightly below a million gallons a day. So we have that restriction. That's why we get water from Andover. Back when one of our wells, the Stickney well years ago, was damaged as a result of the spill at GE.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then that was about the time that, so that well was down. We had to get additional water. And then the grandfathering came into place. So we're kind of hard-pressed, and even investing in the existing wells may not even get us as many gallons a day. And it would seem that the best solution is a single solution rather than, and I think you guys have gone through some of this with taking water out of the Ipswich and phasing in MWRA in two phases or whatever. And I think, you know, we as a board have the responsibility of providing a long-range solution to water for the town, and as you mentioned, our initiative of expanding our economic growth, we're about 12%. Tax rate is generated by our commercial base, and it's far not enough to support the growing budgets both in town and school.
We love 12, but we're 8. another thing that's not much discussed, but all of us in the room should acknowledge, the MWRA is expert at distributing water. We're not. We did a great job with our water treatment plant. You know, the water quality was as good as it could be. But both management, you know, including elected officials, had that burden of risk.
Yeah.
We were responsible for the water for our residents. Now we have an organization that's much larger, deeper pockets, more expertise. It's their responsibility. So, you know, some of the things, again, as local government, you can't do everything well. You want to pick the things you want to focus on, and the MWRA is clearly an expert at this. And again, our experience with them has been, I think, better than any of us could have envisioned. And not that we were being pessimistic, it's just been that much better, both from the quality, their responsiveness is great, and the prices have been pretty well behaved, I have to say, and well telegraphed in advance. They do a good job.
Bob, could you comment on how the two water systems will do their own billing and how we're going to put the meter at the border, meters?
I'll describe what I understand. I haven't seen this in writing, but I'll describe it. MWRA is going to measure water that goes through the, if you will, Stoneham Reading line, and we're going to have two sets of meters for checks and balances. We already do. We'd like the same checks and balances on the North Reading line for redundancy, and they will effectively bill North Reading the amount they measure that goes into North Reading, and they will bill Reading the amount of water that goes into Reading minus what North Reading is billed. Okay. So we're kind of the difference of whatever they use, you know, comes off us. But MWRA will bill each community separately.
Yep.
So there'll be no reason for Reading to bill North Reading or figure anything out. Our MWRA will take care of all of that. And that's something we did discuss. We really weren't sure what the MWRA's intentions were.
I think that actually works out better for both communities.
Yeah, we're both independent
doing
that way.
That way, it seems to me.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Bob, can you talk about what potential disruptions there may be to the town of Reading in putting this through? Street closures, traffic diversions.
Sensitive areas, I know the CONSCOM.
You know, I would say at this point, very minimal. And to be more specific, we just don't know yet because they haven't settled on a final path. You know, Mill Road has been discussed, but there is not a final solution, if you will. I don't know, Jeff, do you see a lot of disruption in Reading? It'd just be like we're doing some water main work ourselves. It's just not that big of a deal.
It's probably not far off. We'd be doing, maybe doing them anyway, you know.
Yeah, instead of putting in an 8-inch main, we're putting in a 12-inch main.
Yeah, and the size of the main doesn't change the, you know, the road interruption. The road interruption is the road interruption.
So when the two towns got together and the engineering staffs compared notes, and these are their words, not mine, they found there was a lot less infrastructure work needed to make this happen.
Where we have sensitive crossings like the Ipswich, if it goes up the Mill Street, the MWRA, I believe, said no problem going underground.
They did mention that last week, yeah, first I've heard of it.
Okay, well, we would like to see that. I would like to see that.
Okay.
I trust the board would, too.
Okay.
Just another question. Bob, why do you think that this would, I mean, maybe by law have to go to town meeting, but more as a, I mean, we're doing something that really is sort of, you know, out of the box, you know, entering into an agreement, you know, long-term agreement with a neighboring town, and for all the right reasons, I may add, but wouldn't this normally should go to a town meeting, or?
It would have needed to go to a town meeting, A, if we were borrowing any money, right, or making any kind of expense ourselves, or B, if it was gonna turn out that the MWRA was gonna bill us the whole amount, and then they would help us, or we would figure out how much we build them. Because then our water enterprise fund would, let's say, double in size. At $6 million, maybe it would go to $10 million, and then they'd pay us $4 million. So town meeting would have to approve a larger budget. Neither of those is true. As is the case with any other regional arrangement, they're intermunicipal agreements. And the only ones, to my knowledge, that still need to go through town meeting are Board of Assessors or Assessors.
I think it would be prudent to give a detailed report at the subsequent town meeting in November about this. That would maybe cover the ground.
At that point, you probably have some more thoughts on design by early November.
So, at our June 6th town meeting, there's an article, there's two articles. One is to provide funds for the engineering work that has to be done. And that goal is to have that underway and squared away so that following June town meeting, we'd be going and asking for the entire capital not to get the job done. And second is to authorize the Board of Selectmen to join the MWRA.
So November's possible, but April's sounds for certain.
Yeah, that sounds like it's more likely. So what would you, is there anything you folks would like to add or like to, you know, enter the discussion? You should feel free to do that. Here, I know you're here to answer questions, and we may end up with some, but I don't want to preclude you from feeling like you can't comment here, because you certainly can. You invited us to do that.
Well, Bob did a good job of taking you know, what was presented at our workshop last week and put it together for you.
Yeah.
There are a couple of our board members that but one member wasn't present for the workshop. I don't know if any of the other board members of the town administrator has any comments, but he's feel free to
speak up. So the chairman spoke to the update in terms of the project and what we'll be asking for town meeting to approve in June relative to design. The only thing I would add is your board and the town manager were active participants last week at the water workshop, and I know that that was appreciated from the town standpoint, from the board standpoint, and from our residents, who I think really valued your sharing the experience that Reading had relative to the transition. So I just wanted to say thank you for your attendance and for staying the 3+ hours for the meeting that evening as well.
Oh, we like this.
You're not out of here.
We're going to keep you here.
Yeah, and for the members of the public that are here and those that are watching at home, we did, three of us were able to visit and call ourselves to order actually in North Reading for the first time since I've been on this board.
Yeah, I think you're right.
And
in history of me being.
And so, you know, a version from the perspective of North Reading was presented in what was titled a water workshop, which I think was a really nice opportunity for, I want to say you must have 40 or 50 members of the public who
many guests. It seemed like there was a lot, big room, and they were spread out. A lot of great questions. Ask us a few, but you know, this has been a work in progress for a long time, and I think that you know, I do think that there's kind of a mutually beneficial thing going on here, and you know, it seems to be, you know, moving along. But we wanted to open the opportunity for members of our public to talk about this. And is there anybody from the public that would like to comment or question? Yes, sir.
Good evening, and thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Jonathan Barnes, Pratt Street in Reading, and a member of the Historical Commission.
Sorry, I misspoke.
Yeah. Actually, you didn't. The Conservation Commission, I'm not sure if they're here. I know they were here earlier. But
sure, they're interested.
They've also spoken on this as well. Okay. But thank you, Mr. Selectman. And with me is Virginia Adams, also from the Historical Commission. And I just wanted to bring attention. I actually have, I know, brought the board's attention, probably in nauseating detail, as well as to the representatives in North Reading, who have been extremely professional and cooperative in this process as well. And I've attended several of those meetings in North Reading. Also, I just wanted to bring one issue that is important to us, to the public's attention and to your attention, to the representatives in North Reading. With respect to this process, it wasn't mentioned tonight, but the sort of formal onset of the process, I guess I would describe, is the filing of the draft environmental impact report with the state Department of Environmental Protection or Department of Environment. That process has started, and that, I guess, is the official announcement for which or after which there is public comment, and we have provided public comment, which I know you've seen, as well as representatives from North Reading. I just want to raise one issue, and it's with one aspect of the project briefly, and that is in the state requires, as the DER references, an acknowledgement of the historic places and archaeological resources and how they might be affected, as Selectman Ensminger mentioned. And I just want to raise one issue that is important to us that I think needs to be clarified, at least in the official DEIR. I would also want to acknowledge that as a result of this process, there was also supposed to be a water pump station located at that location. And for the public's information, that area at the Mill Street Bridge is the area of the Lobs Pound Mill, which is an enormously significant site in the history of the town of Reading and in the history of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. That's was the site of the original grist mill and sawmill for the town of Reading, which was in operation from 1690s until 1892. Also on that site is the old water pump station for Reading, which was in operation from 1892 as well. That site is designated by the state. It's on the inventory with the Mass Historical Commission. It's also on our inventory as an archaeological landmark site, and therefore needs to be protected legally as well as morally and historically. And I just want to bring to your attention the fact that the town of Reading has graciously agreed to locate their necessary water pump station as a part of this project, which was originally going to be on at that location. They have graciously agreed to move that to other North Reading site, so it will not affect the site, and we are enormously grateful about that. However, in the DEIR, and this is what I just wanted to underscore, in the section where the town needs to reference any impacts on archaeological and historical sites, the DEIR states that as a result of the pump station being relocated elsewhere, the DER states that other impacts are anticipated to be minimal, as any other historical sites in Reading are located off site of the project, and as any construction will occur on the roadway, it should not impact any of those historical sites. And I just wanted to underscore, as I probably have on many occasions, that is not entirely accurate. The Mill Street bridge is an integral part of the archaeological site. And I think I referenced at that last meeting, and I've referenced it before. I should also note that the archaeological landmark site extends about 100 feet as a radius from that location, so that the entire protected site is rather large. That Mill Street Bridge, which, if the DEIR is correct, and I understand it's flexible, and that's what I wanted to encourage, if the connection to Reading Water and the water mains are going to extend through the roadway and over that bridge is an integral part of the archaeological and historic site. I referenced the other day, I don't know if anybody's seen the site, it's a beautiful location, especially now, the water's high. But the undergirding of that bridge contains the enormous granite blocks that were a part of the original mill. I also want to note, by the way, that the sawmill and the grist mill is conveniently located right in the center of the room on the town seal, which I think underscores the significance and importance of that location. But my point is that if there still is a need to take that water main and move it across that bridge, or under that bridge, probably more significantly, it's our belief that's not a minimal adverse impact. That is a significant adverse impact. And we would like the Reading Selectmen and the town to strongly encourage, as well as the town of North Reading, to encourage any alternative that doesn't so adversely impact. And on at least two occasions that I've attended meetings there, the representatives from North Reading, as well as their consultants from Wright Pierce, did indicate, as you pointed out, Selectman Ansminger, that it is a routine procedure to tunnel under rather than across or through, depending on the geological circumstances. But I just wanted to reference the importance, the continuing importance of that aspect of the site. And if the intention is to take that water main across that roadway, or in any way through that site, to be sensitive in particular to the archaeological significance, and to preferably go underground. Thank you.
Yeah, Will Finch, sort of here partly on behalf of the Ipswich River Watershed Association, and to kind of tie in with what Jonathan has been talking about, that I know Wright Pierce would like to do horizontal boring under the riverbed to avoid disturbing the bridge. But I think there may well be bedrock under there, and I think they should be anticipating that. I still think that we should try and achieve that goal of boring under the bridge. But I just want to alert you to the fact that the other dams on the Ipswich River, the one in Ipswich and the one in Middleton, are built on bedrock, or originally they were falls on the river. It's a convenient place to put a dam because you've already got a good foundation. So that may well be the situation here also. So it's going to be a bigger hurdle if there is bedrock there, but the previous town manager was very proud of the project that he worked on to rebuild that bridge, to make it safe for traffic, but also to maintain its historic appearance and character. And any kind of pipe that's exposed on the side of the bridge is really going to take away from the integrity of the whole site. So I think we're going to try as hard as we can. But, I mean, I'm sure it's possible to drill through rock. It's going to be harder, but if there is rock there, I just want to push that issue and then support the horizontal boring option.
Any other comments from the public? From the board?
Virginia, have you?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, Virginia.
This wasn't advertised to the public that you'd be discussing this issue, other than it was an item on your agenda. Is that
correct? That is correct. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not a public hearing, Virginia. That is correct. So from that perspective,
There's nothing we're voting on.
Yeah, I mean, there's not a vote, there's a discussion, and, you know, it's, as always, was posted, you know, as part of our agenda item. And you know, frankly, at town meeting, I made a point of bringing it up in the state of the town that we were in discussions. Bob has done the same thing. So, you know, I mean, it's not as though, you know, we certainly want it to be an open and transparent public process. I can tell you unequivocally that in the period of time that Dan and I have been in discussions with Bob and the team from North Reading, the minute that there was some realization that that might be the spot, everyone from North Reading realized that that was going to, you know, that that was certainly going to be a cause for concern. There was, you know, immediate reaction to, oh, well, we've got to think of something different and a better way to do it. So that's the way I've watched it progress, I think, in the direction that you're hopeful that this goes. So
I think what I'm hearing from them is the Historical Commission would like to be proactively notified, maybe,
and that's
with
that's
our agenda being
we're
sent
happy
in advance.
To do that.
Does that cover it?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And I just wanted to clarify that issue about we gratefully acknowledge and appreciate the immediate response from the town of North Reading with respect to the pump station. I wanted to just underscore the fact that the characterization in the DEIR, which I know folks recognize now, is not entirely accurate in the sense that there is a continuing concern about the roadway and the bridge itself. I just wanted to bring that up.
And I think that what's important to note is that, you know, in the grander sense of what this project's about and what it means to the citizens of North Reading and how we're able to help as neighbors, it's not to diminish this issue, but to deal with this issue is something that they've expressed a lot of interest in doing, because working around that is going to, it makes for a better finish. It makes for everything to work well and kind of smoothly. So I think that that's been my observation all along. I say that to both of you, you know, unequivocally. And we're happy, I think, every time we're going to be having one of these discussions, you know, in a public setting to make you aware of it.
Appreciate it.
So I just want to ask you, is the comment period still open on the DEIR, or is it closed?
I think it ended in early May. I think
okay.
May, it was extended till May 6th.
All right.
Record, you know?
May 13th.
Do
May
we
13th.
Have our comments officially on the record in that regard?
Sorry?
Did the town of Reading enter comments along the lines of what your concerns are?
I know the Historical Commission did.
Okay.
I can't speak for any other entity.
Well, that's
so,
fine.
So
that's,
we're on the
record.
Record. Yeah.
So.
And Mass Historical Commission has submitted comments as well.
Good, good.
I just want to say, you know, as a board representing the town, we appreciate your comments and a concern. And, you know, our engineering firm is well aware of it. They are looking at the best way to get across the river.
Yeah.
And, I'm sure that the FEIR will, you know, clear up any of the ambiguities, because at that point, this is what we're doing.
Right. Yeah. That's right. Steve, did you have a comment that you wanted to make?
No, other than it's great to be back in Reading. it's only been about 30 years
30
or so. Yeah, 30 years or so. And I know Mrs. Adams from way back when, too. Still advocating. Strongly. But again, in relation to your concerns, obviously we're sensitive to them and we remain sensitive to those. And we're just looking for some sort of engineering solution to it, which I'm sure can be done, and maybe at an additional cost if there's a bedrock there.
Yep.
But again, as far as the cooperative effort thus far, it's been fantastic and greatly appreciated from our standpoint. It appears to us, again, that it is a win-win situation for your community as well as ours. We do have some mutual interest here, and you know, we have a problem in relation to the amount of water that we need, that we have to use, and where we're going to get it. And this seems to be the best economic solution for us, long-term solution. And we certainly appreciate all the effort that Reading is putting into it to bring it to fruition. So we'll have a town meeting in June, which will be the first step to get the engineering design, and then they'll go back for the rest of it.
Yeah, I think that's the important thing to note is that, you know, the next hurdle for North Reading is to clear through their town meeting funds to really properly start to get design and engineering, you know, going downstream, or under the stream.
Under the stream.
But as far as the intermunicipal agreements, again, we have one with Andover,
right.
But that also took an act of the legislature because there's an interbasin transfer
from
the Merrimack River versus the Ipswich River watershed at the time back in the early 1990s. And it's worked out very well, and Andover's been very good neighbors. And as far as the redundancy portion of this, even the MWRA is somewhat excited about the prospects of.
Well, you know, I do think that any good deal, everybody needs to have their share of winning in the deal, and their share of, you know, trade-offs to make it work. And so it seems like that's where it's all headed. So, any other questions, comments, concerns? Yes.
Yes, Jeff Yule, Selectman. It's not often that you come across a situation that brings two towns together to work together and work together in a way that is constructively positive for both communities. So it's good to be working with a community and a board such as yours in a very amicable way to resolve issues that both towns need to resolve.
Well, thank you. And we didn't. We got over being mad that you guys left.
Yeah, he wants you back, I think.
He wants us all.
Be careful what you ask for.
You can have the job.
Actually, when on your way out, you can help yourselves to some Reading tap water.
Yes.
we're drinking it all the
right
time.
Right out of the tap.
I tried it out of the water.
You can report back to the people in North Reading about how tasty.
I know that there's actually, and that's a fair thing to be concerned about, but it really is.
I believe you people have more on your agenda.
Yes.
So
we've kept you here long enough.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
No need to reciprocate
of us
as long as we can.
Thank you for your patience.
We're going to move on. I did want to mention that, you know, working with John and Dan and Bob as the subcommittee, I mean, it's been a real pleasure. And, you know, a real genuine effort to make this thing happen. That's well appreciated.
Very good.
And with that, I'll call for a motion to adjourn our meeting.
So moved.
Do we have a second? Second by Mr. Manatelli. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in.
Safe trip home.
Might stop at a restaurant.
Okay. Can we bail you?
The day may never come. We are on to a change of beneficial interest application.
Yeah, not yet.
Okay.
For all alcohol beverage restaurant liquor license for Anthony's Coal Fired Pizza, 48 Club.
This is not a hearing, I don't
think. It is not a hearing.
No, that's you're not there yet. That's the next one.
Okay. So what we got here is a change of beneficial interest. Do we have the? Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, this is Anthony's. Okay.
Oh, my name is Joe Gill. I'm an attorney with Demarcus Law Offices in New Massachusetts. Okay. And I represent Anthony's Coal Fired.
Thanks for your patience tonight.
That's all right. I'm a city councilor in Newbury.
You understand how this came up.
My partners think I'm sick, but I'm like, this is interesting. These restaurant chains partner essentially through buy-in with equity funds, investment fund firms. That's a general, you know, Bertucci's, 99, Outback, before Outback Republic. That's what allows them to expand. So, for instance, they're opening one in Little, because of this deal, this Catterton Partners is now, and there's different size funds for the size of the chain or the hotel as they get bigger and bigger. So they're opening one in Littleton. It might either open last week or it opens this week. Northborough, Newton, it'll probably be, you know, maybe four or five more this, you know, in the next year, 12 months. So what effect it has is the Littleton one actually has already been submitted to it's before the ABCC, this exact application. So it's nothing's changing at the location itself. The manager's the same, the operation's the same, the menu's the same. It's basically just, this is the fine, this is how they
different blending of money.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
All right.
So questions?
No. Go for it.
Any public comment? Okay.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the change in beneficial interest application for an annual all alcoholic beverage restaurant license, Anthony's Coal Fire Pizza, Reading, LLC, DBA, Anthony's Coal Fire Pizza, 48 Walker's Brook Drive, Reading, Mass.
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now we have a
okay. Now you're
no, we have one.
We have a hearing.
We're going to hear
yep.
first.
Yep, 23.
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on May 17, 2016 at 9:10 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. On the transfer of an all-alcohol restaurant liquor license from Ristorante Pavarotti to Boston Foods Incorporated, DBA, Ristorante Pavarotti at 601 Main Street, Reading, Mass. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, 7:30, until we close. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or email prior to 6 p.m. May 17, 2016 to town manager at ci.reading.ma.us by order of Robert W. Lasher, town manager.
We have the applicant.
Hi, yes, yeah. Hi, how are you? My name is Cannon, and I'm one of the manager and owners. And for past history, like we do have a couple more restaurants, one in Chelmsford and one in Newton. So we have been basically chefs from all over years. And so that's why we just wanted to start, getting this business and then running the same way it is. Yeah, no change of menus. This is going to be the same.
Not going to be Indian cuisine? It's going to
No, not Indian cuisine. Yeah, we just want to try the way it is because we have been trained in Italian and French cuisines and all. So we worked as the chefs for Marriott and Newton and Renaissance at the Foxborough Stadium.
Okay.
So we have the knowledge of running it. So worst come worst, we must change it into a different cuisine what we are into, that's all it is, yeah.
And how long have you been in the restaurant business and how many restaurants do you have?
We have one in Chelmsford and one in Newton Highlands. It's the one in Newton Highlands is a vegetarian and vegan, organic.
Mm-hmm.
And the one in Chelmsford is an Indian restaurant. And since we have started our own businesses since 2011.
And the staff has had no concerns?
If you look at page 24 of your handout tonight, summary from the police department.
Yep.
I find no reason why the license application should not go forward.
Okay.
You gentlemen are fully committed to TIPS training?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, do you want to give your usual admonition?
Certainly. So I think it's always important when someone comes to our town that is going to be applying for a liquor license that you be aware that several things happen. One of them is we're very interested in the enforcement of the law.
Yep.
We're very interested in the fact that you're going to be TIPS trained and all of those people serving alcohol will be trained appropriately. And I guess furthermore, what's really important, it's important for you to know that our police chief will dispatch people into your place of business at some time through the course of the year. We'll test that system.
Yeah, sure.
It's part of what we do here, and we do it because we take a very firm position around serving alcohol to adults, never to children. And so it's kind of always important to us. I do think that we have the record for the longest suspension in the state of Massachusetts for multiple violations of the drinking age.
Longest upheld.
Longest upheld.
Yep.
Yes.
And that's not because we're anything other than completely serious about who uses alcohol in our town. And so it's just an admonition you know that we're assuming that you'll never be in here to talk to us about that.
Yeah. You'll only ever be in here to tell us business is good, and you'd like to renew your license, and maybe you want to open a second restaurant. I mean,
yeah, sure.
That, you know, that's how
that's
we hope
we like
to see
to
you. Because mm-hmm. The other way is, you know, we're...
No
we're,
fun for anybody.
Yeah,
no
we're,
fun
we're,
for
it's
us.
It's no fun
either.
For anybody. Okay.
That's
and,
true, yeah.
And, it, you know, it's not fair to not let somebody that's new in town know our position on that. So it's good for you to know that.
Yeah.
So what else we got,
just,
Jerry?
Just one other quick question for those
yeah,
folks
sure, yeah.
in town who might have bought gift certificates to the Pavarotti's restaurant. Would you
yes.
honor those as the new
We
will
sure honor those, sir. We'll sure honor those.
Okay. I have one of those.
Yeah. I was asking
just
selfishly.
As a,
yeah.
still be honored like somebody
great.
Yesterday, they got it from 2012.
Mm-hmm.
Still be honored then.
Oh, okay.
That's good.
Okay, great.
Oh, great.
It's good
great.
To know.
And when do you close? When
the closing is on after the license comes. We're just getting our training going on now, so
okay.
we're just working with the previous owner to get
right.
some training and how it works. Yeah,
right.
the system works. Yeah. That's
I think I saw your lease begins June 1st. Is that
yes,
true?
It is. Yes.
Okay.
So, and how fast will the license transfer form about?
30 days, maybe a little less.
30 days, pretty much 30 days.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
thank you.
So that's where we are here, and so it sounds like you guys will be. The new owners and operators sometime in the month of June once we finish things up in here tonight. Is that right?
Yeah.
So, any other, yes,
oh,
other
no,
questions? Any other questions or discussion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the transfer of the all-alcohol restaurant liquor license from Ristorante Pavarotti Inc. to Boston Food Inc. DBA Ristorante Pavarotti at 601 Main Street.
Second that.
And then move that the Board of Selectmen
You want to
oh,
vote
no,
on
we
it?
To vote.
Yeah, we
have
to vote.
Have to vote. So we just closed the hearing.
Yeah.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? Okay, hearing's closed.
4-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the application for the transfer of the all-alcohol restaurant liquor license from Ristorante Pavarotti Inc. to Boston Foods Incorporated DBA Ristorante Pavarotti at 601 Main Street for a term expiring December 31st, 2016, subject to the following conditions. All bylaws, rules, and regulations of the Town of Reading and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts shall be followed and subject to a satisfactory inspection of the establishment by the town manager or his designee.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Congratulations.
Thank
you
so
much. Best of
luck. Welcome to Reading.
Thank you for your patience tonight.
Welcome to welcome to Reading.
Right. Oh, sure.
Thank you.
All right.
Have a great night.
Now, I think we've got some minutes to take care
yep.
of.
Should I just make the motion?
Sure.
Yes.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of May 3rd, 2016 as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? I would,
So.
Oh, wait 16? We need a one-day.
No, that's
no,
Bob's.
Bob
can do
that.
So then I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 10:16 p.m.
Yes.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye aye.
Aye aye.
Fade to black.